Good morning. Could I welcome everyone to the third meeting of the Education and Skills Committee? And can I please remind everyone present to turn off their mobile phones as they can interfere with the sound system? The first item is to allow Richard Lockhead to declare any interests that are relevant to the work of the committee. Can I welcome Richard and invite his declaration?
Thank you, Convener. Pleasure to be here, and no official declaration of interests. Unofficially, I should say my wife is a primary school teacher, therefore maybe a source of free advice, irrespective of whether asked for or not, but that's the only interest I wish to declare today.
Thank you very much. The next item of business is to consider taking items 5 and 6 of this meeting in private. Item 6, to discuss our approach to budget scrutiny, and item 5 will be a chance for us to discuss and reflect on what we hear today from the panel. It's also suggested that similar review items are taken in private in subsequent meetings this month. Are we agreed that we will take those items in private? Thank you very much. Item 3 is the overview of further and higher education. We have in front of us the panel of witnesses, and this is the first of a number of overview panels this month. These sessions will inform consideration of our future work programme and a session with the Cabinet Secretary on the 28th of February. So before welcoming the witnesses, can I begin by putting on record my thanks to all those who organised and took part in the fact-finding visits in relation to further and higher education at the University of Stirling last week and on skills at Stirling Community Enterprise. The practical experience members heard on these visits provide valuable insight and context for these overview sessions. I'd now like to welcome Shona Struthers, Chief Executive from College Scotland, Professor Andrea Nolan, Convener of University Scotland, Vonnie Sandlin, President of National Union of Students Scotland, and John Kemp, Interim Chief Executive of Scottish Funding Council. Good morning. I'd like to go straight to questions, and the first question I have is regarding a report in the Herald this morning about the new university scheme to lure students from working class. Could anybody give me some further information on this?
I'd be happy to update you. This is part of our response to the Commissioner of Widening Access report that came out earlier in the year in March, A Blueprint for Fairness. And in University Scotland, all the principals have come together to say, how can we actually deliver the step change? We've been working hard over the last 4 or 5 years and even beyond that to actually improve access to higher education as part of a holistic drive through schools and colleges. And I'm sure my colleagues will speak about that. And so we came up with a plan to deliver what are ambitious targets, but targets that we are all committed to, which really revolves around three areas. The first is around improving our admission systems, kind of reviewing them. 17 of our 19 universities across Scotland use contextualised admissions, so there are flags that we can identify if people are coming from less advantaged backgrounds. We've been doing this on an individual basis and looking at what works, what doesn't work. We have some evidence now that students from deprived backgrounds in particular, that may have had more challenges in the getting opportunities to develop their skills and expertise, that if we admit them in some areas with lower grades, they do really well. And what's really important to us as university principals is that people succeed when they're admitted and they go on to have good outcomes in the employment. So we're looking at spreading our best practice, sharing that further. So that's one area. The second area we're looking at is around our bridging programmes. Our evidence now indicates that delivering bridging programmes, so if people are coming from school or from colleges, to get our prospective students aware of what university is like, not to be daunted by it, not to feel underconfident, and that there's other people like you. We've been doing that on an individual university basis largely, and we feel that if we come together more and maybe offer things on a regional, potentially a national, who knows, but we're going to develop our bridging programmes collaboratively. And I think if we do that, we have the potential to offer more places to people on bridging programmes and summer school activities that will help them transition into university and believe that university is for them. And the third area which we plan to do more work on is streamlining, and that will be in collaboration with our colleagues in the college sector, streamlining our articulation routes to ensure that people have a range of opportunities and pathways into university.
Okay, and when would you see this piece of work being done and being ready to be put into action?
Well, a lot of the building blocks are there because we've done a lot of things individually. So we agreed the plan last week at our University of Scotland. We spent at our away day, and we will be putting together a board to deliver it. These things, the actions don't take. We will put in place during this year. The impact takes a while to see as you get more people through into the system, as more people attain the qualifications to come into university. So the impact will take a while, but the actions we're committed to moving on in this academic year.
Do they also have any comments on this?
I think it's worth saying that builds on actions that universities have been taking for some years. These are tried and tested methods. They contextualise admissions. There's now quite a lot of research behind that, showing that people with particular grades from one particular that school might perform as well as somebody with far higher grades from a different school. So there's a lot of strong research behind this. What Andrea has described as streamlining there, the articulation work is something that has grown quite a lot in recent years, but still has the capacity to grow further and be quite an important way of widening access to quite a large number of students. It's something we very strongly support.
That the college sector is very much looking at the articulation route to develop the learner journey, and although we've got some good examples of articulation, it's just not right across the board. So we want to see that much more across the board, with colleges and universities being much more of a standard route rather than just specific partnerships which have been created.
Sam, do you have any comment to make on it?
I mean, just to say really that NUS Scotland absolutely welcomes University of Scotland being so bold and decisive before the Commissioner for Fair Access has even been implemented, and we're very excited about the opportunities that this sort of collaborative national approach and regional approach is going to have for students. We absolutely believe that articulation is a jewel in the crown of the Scottish education system. It is a wonderful opportunity for students for whom direct access into university isn't right for whatever reason. We have been very clear at NUS Scotland that where articulation works, it is wonderful. But in recent years, across all institutions in Scotland, 51% of students who are articulating from college to university are being forced to repeat years of study, and only 49% are entering university from college at the year and level that they should. And so this isn't a good or reasonable use of the very sort of limited resources that we have available for tertiary education in Scotland. And so it is really genuinely exciting to hear colleges and universities working more collaboratively to try and sort of make that a more smooth progression.
On that point, is that based on the universities, or is it based on the courses, the sort of 51-49?
That's all students who are articulating from college into university. So there can be a number of reasons for that. There are some institutions who don't have a very smooth alignment between the college course that students are articulating from into the university degree that they're articulating to. There are some courses, for example, law is one that I hear quite a lot, that has to have specific subject matter covered in first and second year, that perhaps a student who's done an HNC or an HND in college won't have covered. But I believe there's absolutely opportunities for that, as Andrea and Shona are talking about, that streamlining of curriculum content to make sure that actually that is still a smoother path.
Yeah, where it works best, the college and the university have worked together to design the course so that there is seamless articulation and the student is well supported. Where people are repeating years, sometimes it's for good reasons, they're changing subject or need that additional support, but sometimes it's because the college and the university haven't designed a route that works.
Thank you very much. Liz, do you want to come in on this subject?
My questions are more about the role, actually, of the Scottish Funding Council when it comes to helping this process. Because if you look at what the Audit Scotland reports have said, both into higher education and to further education, there has been some concern expressed about the clarity of what is that role. So I think it'd be helpful, John, I did read the paper that you provided, but it didn't actually respond to any of the concerns that Audit Scotland have raised. Now, I'm particularly interested in, perhaps come to Professor Nolan in a minute, I'm particularly interested in how you feel that the outcome agreements, which obviously include this widening access, how you would measure the success of that.
The outcome agreements are the means by which we take the government's priorities and the funding for further and higher education and link these two things together. They are agreements between the funding council and the colleges and universities. They are based on negotiations between the college and universities about what is achievable and achieving the ends that we mutually share. We agree with the universities a set of targets for widening access, and built within that are requirements that they have contextualised admissions and so on as well. So we use them as a method for encouraging and linking to funding progress with widening access. I'd stress they are an agreement. They are a collaborative agreement between us and the universities and the colleges about making progress on these things. They are not a simplistic method where we concoct a set of targets in our office and then tell the universities what those are. Now, we do have a set of targets in our office which we then go out and discuss with the universities on widening access. But it is a process of negotiation and agreement about how the funding is used for government priorities. Is that the point you are?
Yes, it is. But could I just ask, why do you think that Audit Scotland are not very comfortable about the clarity of that?
I wouldn't say they were uncomfortable. I mean, the Audit Scotland report on higher education, it did suggest that we need to update the outcome agreement guidance to reflect our new strategic plan, which we are doing at the moment, because the strategic plan is fairly recent and the next set of outcome agreement guidance hasn't come out. I think there is sometimes an expectation that outcome agreements are more directive than they actually are. These are about collaborative working between the university and college sector and the funding council to reflect priorities.
Professor Nolan, just on that theme, obviously the indication is that a great deal more work is being done than will be required to be done, given that the Scottish Government's policy intentions are changing. When it comes to the setting of outcome agreements within the different institutions and the Scottish Funding Council, do you feel that that process is well researched and resourced in terms of the numbers of people who are able to help individual institutions work that up?
Well, there are very positive things about the outcome agreement process in that one has a discussion about your institution and how your institution's missions, given we're all autonomous institutions, how your mission and your strategy, how we can marry the two and deliver to the government's agenda. So it's positive to be able to discuss that. I think with all processes, they can always be improved. They are bilateral discussions. And I think maybe in the future, it might be helpful to consider how we could, at the beginning of a session, actually say, well, these are the things we want to achieve sectorally for the whole year. And we'll now go on and discuss those individually. I think it's very challenging for the Funding Council, particularly in the last year and possibly this year, when our outcome agreements are on a three-year basis, but our funding settlement this year has been a one-year, and it's likely it will be an X one-year for 17-18. That's where it becomes quite difficult because, of course, our planning cycles in universities, we take a student in by the time, from the moment we look to recruit the student to when they graduate is 4+1, 5 years. So that makes it challenging for everybody.
Thank you very much. And I'm interested in the initiatives around widening access, but I wonder if we can maybe look at the context of that, both for the college and the university sector. I've been told that it's harder now for a young person in Scotland to get into university than it was 5 years ago. And as a consequence, places, anecdotally I would say, from one family are being rationed by qualification. Does that not therefore mean that it makes it more difficult to address the attainment gap, when in fact young people who in the past would have access to university course are now not being, because actually because of government policy of funding gap and capping?
The number of Scots domiciled students at universities in Scotland has increased by about 10% in the last 10 years or so. So there is an increase in the number of Scots domiciled students accessing university. I think it's fair to say that demand has probably grown above that, and that's perhaps the success of some of the widening access initiatives. In the long run, is something that is going to have to be considered by this Parliament, by the Government, by the Funding Council, how we make best use of the capacity in colleges and universities to meet the widening access targets. But in the last few years, the number of students from Scotland going to Scottish universities has been increasing. The indication from this year's UCAS statistics are that it's increased again by about 4% year on year. The issue is perhaps that demand is increasing at a greater rate than supply, and some of the changes, the consequential changes of the introduction of fees in England and therefore the charging of our UK students has enabled expansion of the number of places for Scots domiciled students in Scotland. So there has been an expansion, but it's perhaps not enough to satisfy
but
demand.
The increase in demand is an increased number of people who would in the past have accessed a course. So it's not that there's lots of people who want to go who are not able to go. Yeah. These are people who 5 years ago who would have accessed a place who can no longer access a place. Mm-hmm. And therefore the way in which we're managing that demand is by increasing the level of qualification that you require. I would thought that would have made it even more difficult to address the question of the gap in attainment by the time you get to college university level.
Yes, I think we're accepting that the demand has grown more than supply.
And the cap on places, therefore, it means that there is nowhere else for the universities to go but to ration by qualification. Logically?
Yes.
So we are expecting young people to achieve higher qualifications to access a place at university than you would say 5, 10 years ago. So we are actually, you could argue, being in a position where there are young, talented people who could contribute to the Scottish economy who are not able to access a place that would allow them to do that.
But in the long run, that's an issue that we need to consider, you know, collectively, not just the Funding Council, in how we use the supply of places we have in both colleges and universities, because some of the what we've referred to as streamlining or articulation here is a way of using the same number of places but getting more people through. And we also need to consider, you know, the total supply of places.
Can we also address then, I think the other context is around colleges, where we do talk about bridging the opportunity to get from college to university, but we also know that the budgets are down by 18% in the last, since 2014-15, the audit report tells us that disproportionately part-time places have gone, disproportionately women have gone, disproportionately people over 25 have gone. How do you think, perhaps NUS can reflect on this, how does that address the question of equality of access in education?
NUS have been absolutely clear. The protection of FTE places was very much welcomed by us, and the opportunity to have more students able to access a place at college on a full-time basis. But that has come at the expense of part-time places, which disproportionately affect women, disabled learners, mature adult returners. And we would like to see some kind of investment to sort of rebalance that. On your previous point, when you were talking about the opportunity for access, it is worth mentioning that the application to acceptance ratio for 2015 for people from SIND 20 backgrounds was 63%. That's in contrast to people from SIND 80 to 100%, which was 75. That's a percentage gap of 12 points for people from the least deprived communities to people from the most deprived communities in having their application to university accepted. Conversely, 20% of college students, 29% of college students come from SIND 20. So colleges are absolutely seeing an overrepresentation of people from the most deprived backgrounds. And I think there is something there about opportunity and equality of opportunity.
Had an equality assessment on the budget, which leads to the consequence that poorer students disproportionately end up in the college sector, which is cut, and better off students are more likely to access a place at university. Would you agree that you would fail any equality impact assessment on that basis?
I would not like to speculate on what the outcome would be, but what I would say is I think colleges do excellent work in an atmosphere of ever declining resources. And I think that the the chance to go to college to do higher education study is as valid for some students as what university is. But I think it's making sure that students aren't restricted to one path or another on the basis of where they're from.
I just wonder if our colleague from College of Scotland would like to reflect on what you would see as what should the direction of government policy be in order to address this question of equality?
Well, obviously, the cuts to budgets have had an impact on students, and the target of the full-time equivalent to be maintained is welcome. However, the consequence of having a negative impact on part-time learners and therefore on women returners is something that we would like to see the imbalance redressed, absolutely. There are many colleges who, whilst focusing on the young learner who tends to study full-time, have actually looked at admissions on a first-come, first-served basis. And in that way, then, that you do get the older learner still getting the opportunity to come to college. But it shouldn't be one or the other.
But it is one or the other at the moment.
I think we need to move on.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Gillian, you've got some questions around college reform.
My question is around about the sort of admissions aspect of what you were talking about, Professor Nolan. Initially, one of the things that's been brought to my attention is I'm from a rural constituency, and some of the strategies and I suppose the recording of the people coming into universities from, you know, in the widening access agenda from maybe a more sort of deprived background tends to be postcode based. And that doesn't really work in identifying students of that kind from rural areas where, of course, the postcode might be, you know, a small village and you've got, you know, poorer families living next to it. So what are the challenges there? And what would your advice be to us in actually collecting that data? Because we could be looking at missing some targets because we're not identifying that type of student in rural areas.
It's a very good point, and it's one that we have puzzled with and considered over time. I mean, the measures and the targets have been set against the SIMD way of assessing deprivation, which is a composite measure with many things in it. And at a very high level system, kind of national, it does identify areas of people who would live areas of deprivation. However, our evidence or data suggests that 50% of the time, it's kind of right if you measure it against other indicators of deprivation, for example, free school meals. So we find about a 46% overlap that both of those measures identify. So it's not granular, it's not perfect, it's not really, doesn't give you a full picture of how to address the full range of deprivation. And certainly in University of Scotland, we've been looking at other measures, such as free school dinners, or if you're care experienced, or your carer status, you might look at schools with low progression to higher education, various other indicators that we feel we will. Some of us do use, some universities do use in their contextualised admissions to pick up those people who are disadvantaged but who are not, or living in disadvantaged areas but not being picked up by the SIMD 20 measure. It's a good point. Yeah.
It's worth saying that we agree with University of Scotland that the SIMD is not perfect for every purpose. However, at a high level, particularly at national level, of measuring progress and widening access, it is an extremely useful tool. The latest iteration of the SIMD came out, I think it was just last week, and you can go on that, put in your postcode, find out how wealthy or deprived you are. If you look at the maps on that, particularly in urban areas, it is a very clear indication of the background of the student. In rural areas, you're quite correct, it is less good because the data zones are more mixed. And we very much recognise that, you know, somewhere like Robert Gordon's or Aberdeen University, where they are in a more rural area, and an area of quite low deprivation in the urban part of Aberdeen, that the targets that we would expect in those institutions have to be very different. Because if you're in Glasgow, the percentage of the population that's from SIMD 20 or 40 is far higher. So it's a very good overall measure. It is less good at saying you should admit that student as opposed to that student. And it's less good when you get granular in particular institutions, but it's still a very good overall measure.
Do you see a role for any kind of almost like self-declaration in admission forms, or maybe even a checklist? And you mentioned like being through maybe the care system or other criteria. Yeah.
We do, as part of our outcome agreement process, in allow institutions to use other measures as well of widening access. And we are working with University Scotland on a wider basket of measures, including parental income and so on, which will give a better match between what is and isn't a widening access student. I think it's important that we do that in a consistent way across the country, though, so that we can measure the progress of one institution against another. Because institutions do use their own measures, and if you add them up, it's sometimes difficult to say that University X, with those five measures, it's got X percent of its students are widening access, and this university with a different set of measures will have a different set. You know, which one is making best use of our funding to widen access? It's quite difficult to do that if the measures aren't consistent. So we do need consistent measures, but there's no reason that shouldn't be quite a wide basket.
It's worth mentioning as well that actually the application form for SAS, the Student Awards Agency for Scotland, the form that you fill in order to get your student loan and your bursary, does ask questions like, are you a care leaver? And I know that UCAS, which is the sort of the generic application system for most people going to university, is also working really productively with NUS at a national level to look at what other questions should be asked. I think also the Commission for Widening Access was very clear that the data that's available to institutions could definitely be improved. And as John said, although SIMD isn't perfect, is the best that we have right now. I definitely think there is scope for better data production and better data use. I know anecdotally, for example, that the changes to SAS and to UCAS can't always be picked up by institutions and their computer systems. So it's systemic issues around data collection, but it's not just from the applicant, but I suspect there's probably ways that it could be streamlined from schools too.
Okay, thank you.
Point about SIMD. I mean, it's John Kemp's absolutely right. It certainly works for urban areas, but it is a blunt instrument when it comes to rural Scotland, and it hasn't worked for 17 years. So we all need to come up with a better way of doing that. I want to just ask two questions. The first was about Audit Scotland's report into colleges, and I just wanted to clarify, if I could, Mr. Kemp, the point that they made in relation to understanding the merger costs of colleges, in which, of course, the Funding Council published a report last month. But what Audit Scotland specifically said is this will not include costs of harmonising staff terms and conditions, which could be significant. Is that fair comment, and is there a plan to publish those details?
Our report doesn't cover the harmonisation costs, and the reason it doesn't is that there were and we make this point when we look at all the costs of the merger, there are a number of changes happening in the college sector over the period of the merger, some of which were related to merger, some weren't. So it's very difficult to reach an entirely precise answer of what savings are related to merger and what aren't. And part of the change that was happening in the college sector over that time was the move towards national bargaining. And so some of the colleges that were harmonising pay were doing it with an eye to that. Some weren't, and some colleges, the harmonisation didn't cost much, and some it cost quite a bit more. But sometimes that was related to looking forward to national bargaining rather than the cost of the merger. So for that reason, we didn't include it. We're in agreement with Audit Scotland that it is very difficult to be absolutely precise about which changes in costs in colleges are related to mergers. So we've gone for a fairly robust and conservative way of looking at changes in staffing.
And so was there a ballpark? I mean, I take your point that it's not been possible to come up with a precise number, but has it been possible to come up with a broad number? And is that a number that Audit Scotland, as it were, considered to be auditable, for want of a better word?
Part of the complication is we didn't include every merger in the savings figure, and some of the bigger costs were at one of the colleges we didn't include. We have figures on it. They are not ones I'd like to give here, because we're still working on it. Because
it's but at some stage, thank you. The other question I wanted to ask was a more generic question, and it relates to Joanne Lamont's line of questioning. The widening is the widening access agenda that you've all spoken about very logically this morning consistent with developing Scotland's young workforce, which I still think is one of the most seminal pieces of work that's been done in Scotland all the time of this Parliament. Are the two, because of the concentration that Ian Wood had on vocational education, trying to blur the lines of that and take out so many so many barriers to understanding why vocational education is so important. Are those two consistent? And what are you doing to make sure they are, as it were, seamless?
They are consistent, and it's very important that we keep on working to make sure that they don't diverge.
Yeah.
The work that's been done on developing the young workforce, particularly the parts in schools about vocational pathways, need to be things that are linked into a number of possible outcomes when people leave school. If it becomes something where their vocational pathway is seen as not university, then I think that the whole thing will have failed. I just don't believe there is a divide that says vocational is not university and academic is university. So we, in our work with colleges on developing the young workforce, very much want to encourage flexible vocational pathways that allow people to perhaps, at an early age in school, think about particular areas they might want to work in, but don't limit them to particular outcomes, but take them onto vocational courses that might lead to an HN in school and then onto college and then onto university, or it might lead them, into work from any of those outcomes. But it's very important that we see this as one education system, not a separate education system for vocational in a different place from the academic or widening access education system. If we are to introduce the kinds of routes that are going to properly implement developing the young workforce, I think they are ones that help with the aspirations on the Commission for Widening Access as well, because that can be done by improving the learner journey, improving articulation, and creating routes that aren't trying to get everyone to the same, you stay till 6 years and then do a 4-year degree. There will be other routes which I think are a way of both widening access and giving us a first-class vocational education system.
I'd like to just reinforce John's points there. I'm quite clear that university isn't for everybody, and it's not for everybody at 18. It might be for people later on, in their 20s, in their 30s. They may want to do a master's at some point. But what we are about in terms of the developing young workforce, totally aligned with our access agenda, is about the equality of opportunity. So people have the opportunities, and they are not in some way negated by where you've come from, your race, your gender, your whatever.
And I suppose I would support a lot of what's been said. I mean, colleges are great places for many people to learn. And I think the system that we have at the moment is looking a bit institutional. It's looking at schools and looking at colleges and looking at universities. And what we really need to be doing is looking at the individual and seeing, for some people at school in the senior phase, it's much, much better for that individual perhaps to be in college. It's better for the individual and it's better for society. And then I think if you look at the other end, there's where the vocational training or the technical training in college, it can lead on to university for some people, but it doesn't need to. So it's not about seeing them as separate silos. It's very much seeing them as a flow for an individual, and it's also not linear. So you might start at school, and you may go on to university, and you may go back to college, or vice versa. You might go to college onto university. So I think it's about making sure we make things simpler for the individual, and that's all part of our spending review submission around the learner journey.
Can I just ask, that's fair, can I ask one question about one of Sir Ian Wood's recommendations, which was that employers and national industry sector groups should form partnerships with regional colleges to ensure course content is industry relevant. Now, he said that 2 years ago. Has that happened?
It happens daily. That's exactly how college courses are developed.
So I could go to any college and they could show me all of that?
Absolutely.
Yeah. The college outcome agreement is based on a regional skills assessment, which you could ask Gordon McGuinness from SDS about your next session. But they are very much informed by these regional skills assessment and skills investment plans. And we expect to see that reflected in the outcome agreement. The employers groups that are referred to there are being established at the moment. But there's a lot of workforce evidence that goes into the college outcome agreements to make them reflect local need.
I think it's really important when we're talking about widening access and about apprenticeships to be absolutely explicit. The widening access agenda isn't just about getting more young people from deprived backgrounds into university, it's also about getting more young people from not deprived backgrounds at all to think about apprenticeships as a valid method of moving on after school. But I think that has to be taken in context, and NES Scotland's research indicates almost half of apprentices are making choices about what apprenticeships do based on what they can afford, and not on the basis of the information, advice or guidance that they might have received, or indeed on their own career aspirations. Apprentices, for example, are in a very bizarre situation where they are workers, but they're also learners, but they're not treated as workers. They're paid significantly less, but they're not treated as learners. They don't have the opportunity to, for example, co-create their own curriculum. And they're also unable to access benefits that their counterparts in full-time education can access, for example, the council tax exemption. If I can sort of lay that out absolutely bluntly, on the basis of the current apprentice national minimum wage for apprentices between the age of 16 to 19, their annual salary would be £5,544. That's £2,000 below the national poverty line, assuming a standard working week. It's also £2,500 below the maximum amount of student support that's available. Apprentices are treated very differently, and it's a very gendered difference as well. So, for example, in Scotland, childcare apprentices, where, of course, women make up the vast majority, receive a mean hourly pay of £4.23 an hour, which is significantly below mean pay. It's actually the lowest of any apprentice. Conversely, electrotechnical apprentices, which is massively men-dominated, receive the highest mean pay in Scotland, which is £10.10 per hour. Women make up just 5% of those starts.
Daniel, do you want to come in with a
brief supplementary? I mean, I just following on Tavish's point about engagement with employers, it's just that it's specifically the Audit Scotland report mentioned that following its engagement with industry bodies, that it said that maybe hadn't been as fulsome as it might have been expecting. There was some way to go on that. I was just really wondering kind of how you would explain Audit Scotland's finding on that point.
Scotland's point was about the mergers and whether the mergers had created a different dynamic for employers. The point I was making was about the outcome agreement process and how those relate to regional skills assessments. So I think that's the point. From memory, I think it was they spoke to the FSB as part of the look at mergers. Is that
exactly
correct?
Yeah.
Thank you, Colin.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to explore a little bit college governance. As you're aware, there's been a fair bit of controversy over college governance failures in recent times. And I wonder whether the measures that have been taken so far are sufficient to address that and are sufficiently robust to future-proof against this happening again.
The college governance landscape has been massively reformed. We have had a good governance steering group put in place for about 2 years now, and that's populated by all parties in terms of colleges, a National Union of Students, Government Funding Council, trade union members. So together, collectively, what we've looked at is developing our code of good governance. So that's now in place. And the government had its task group as well, which came up with many recommendations. I think what we have now is a different landscape and a different set of rules and regulations that make it much more robust, and that the situations that we've seen in the past belong to legacy colleges. And I think we've got a much better position now with board members who receive more robust training, and we have chairs that are publicly appointed.
I mean, that sounds excellent, but Audit Scotland's report on Scotland's colleges actually says the activities of college boards are not sufficiently transparent. Only one college complying with the Code of Good Governance.
That specifically makes reference to putting on websites, agendas, minutes and board papers. And that's something that we have addressed with the sector recently, and that's improved as we go on. So that's a point that's been addressed.
One of the key measures was external assurance to mitigate the risk of future issues arising, and that would be principally SFC. Are the measures in place to reassure us on that point?
The Public Audit Committee will be considering quite soon some of the reports on the college sector this year. Now, last year we had quite a lot of discussion about North Glasgow College and Coatbridge College, and there was quite a lot of discussion about whether the SFC, you know, had been robust enough and how it dealt with those issues. The issues that are in front of, will be in front of the Public Audit Committee this year, relating to Clyde College and GCRB, I think, you know, indicate that, you know, we have taken a, you know, a fairly robust line, you know, with those issues which did come up last year. So I think there are a set of procedures in place, partly to do with the reclassification of colleges as public bodies, partly to do with the Code of Good Governance, and partly lessons learned from, you know, instances like Coatbridge, I think, put us, you know, in a different place from where we were a couple of years ago.
So you can give us that reassurance?
I can give you reassurance that we are in a position to act robustly where there are problems. I can't give you a reassurance that there'll never ever be any problems. We are working with the college sector to do the Code of Governance, and I am fairly sure that the incidence of problems will be less than it might have been in the past. I can't give you a reassurance there'll never be any.
I was kind of hoping for a yes or no there, but...
well, it's a yes.
Sounds like a qualified yes. Do you think that the inequalities that were highlighted in the Griggs report in January 2012 have been addressed through the recent college reforms, notably through regionalisation and the activity to improve the governance of colleges?
You mean inequalities in gender on boards?
Yes.
Perhaps Shona could answer. There has been progress.
In Professor Griggs' report, there was a whole list of different inequalities. And I think what we've seen since then to now is the reform of the college sector on many different fronts. I'm sure this committee is well versed on it, but we've seen the mergers, which is structural changes. We've seen regionalisation, which is where the colleges and the employers looked to make sure that there's opportunities in the region that are addressed. We've seen the colleges brought into the public sector and have to adhere to ONS reclassification, and we've seen the reintroduction of national bargaining. So what Professor Griggs listed was a lot of different inequalities, and all those different reforms have addressed quite a lot of them in different ways. But it's been a very complex landscape with lots of different change simultaneously. I think what we've got now are colleges, some of them significantly larger, so they're much more, they have much more clout in their region, and they're working better with employers. I think the college sector is set up better to work with schools and universities and employers. So I think there's a lot of the inequalities that Professor Griggs highlighted in his report have actually been addressed.
I agree there are a large number of inequalities. I suppose I was really thinking, maybe simplistically, at the gender balances on boards so on, which obviously are very
difficult
at the moment. I don't have the latest figure, perhaps Shona does, but I mean, the gender balance on college boards, and the reason I don't have a precise answer is that the college boards reformed themselves over the last year or so, so it might have changed, but it wasn't far off 50-50 even before it was reformed, so I would imagine it's gotten better.
Actually recently did a survey of each of the college boards and looked at gender, so I'd be very happy to submit that to the committee. I, from memory, I think it sat around the 35-40% for females on boards.
That sounds a lot better than it was a few years ago, that's for sure. Can I ask whether the original intention of college governance changes has delivered on the aim of putting learners at the heart of colleges? Because that was in the report of the Review of Further Education Governance in Scotland in January 2012.
Well, I was going to say, I could say just 2 points. I think you've now got students on boards, and I'm sure Bonnie will pick that point up. And I think we've now got a student association framework, which is a big improvement on where things have been in the past. So in terms of putting learners at the centre, I think student voice is absolutely there. But
up on that, that's absolutely right, and certainly I was a college student president in 2012 when the merger processes were sort of just beginning, and my own experience as a volunteer student president sitting on the board of my college and the board of the regional merger group, and also studying full-time and also on placement 2 days a week, and also I've got kids, there's no student that's ever going to be in that situation again. as long as the status quo continues. Every college now has a student association that has at least one sabbatical full-time officer, and their job is to represent the interests of students to the college and nationally too. Of course, there's work to be done in terms of developing students associations. NUS Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council have a partnership project which develops and supports students' associations to constantly get better. I think when you compare university students' associations who have existed for a significant amount of time, who usually have sort of far higher block grant support in order to be able to fund their activities, and compare that to college students' associations, are very, very different bodies. But the nature of college is very different to university as well, with a far more transient student body who may only stay at college for 1 year before moving on. Certainly, I think before Professor Grigg's report, there's significant difference in the way that learners are treated within colleges. Is it perfect? No. Nothing ever is, really. I suppose the status quo is never good enough, but I certainly think the intention and the partnership approach is there. And as Shona said, the framework for colleges is used by students' associations and their colleges to build a partnership approach to make sure that the learner is at the centre.
You were wanting to come in briefly on the point that was raised.
Supplementary convener, given that Coatbridge College was specifically mentioned by yourself, John, I'm just looking as a constituency MSP if that situation has been fully addressed and assurances can be given that it's unlikely to happen again.
Yes, New College Lanarkshire was the final post-merger evaluation was of New College Lanarkshire. That the college is operating well, and so on the specific instance of what happened at Coatbridge, I think there's no risk of that happening again in that college.
Colin fairly significantly beat me to the punch on what I was going to ask about, which was the relative weakness of student representation in colleges compared to not just universities but schools as well. When we look at the education journey, when you take parents and guardians into account, the relative political lobbying power of those at school or who represents them and universities is much larger than at college. I'd suggest that's why the college sector has perhaps seen cuts to its budget disproportionate to other sectors. And was just going to ask, but Vonnie covered it quite significantly, how do we continue to improve the voice of college students, not just in their own institutions, but in the national conversation about that sector?
I think it's really interesting, again, if you can reflect back on sort of pre-2012 to now. I've been very lucky to be involved with NUS Scotland, first of all as a volunteer and now as a full-time officer since the regionalisation process was in tract. And, you know, NUS Scotland is absolutely hyper aware that the vast majority of our membership is college students. But we're talking about issues that affect college students in a way that I don't think NUS ever has before, because the voice of college students has been strengthened through the Student Association development. And that was first of all funded through transformation funding while the regionalisation process was happening. And now colleges are funding that themselves. There are some colleges who are doing, or some college students' associations who are doing very, very well. There are others who are perhaps a little bit smaller or who, for whatever reason, aren't quite at the same level of progression and development. But we're working with them to develop their structures as a student association to ensure that they have that institutional memory year on year. Because I think for college students' associations, that's really the biggest weakness that they've had, is that universities have got abundance of staff members within their students' associations who know year on year what's been worked on, what hasn't, what has been lobbied on, what hasn't, what successes has the student association had in pursuing their own agenda. Whereas with college students associations, that hasn't always been the case because there hasn't been that institutional memory. And so when you get a new student officer team in every year, historically before there was sabbatical officers, a lot of them may have dropped out of their role during the year as soon as NABs or graded units came up, because it's a lot of work taking on that kind of level of responsibility, and sometimes that has to give when you've got to focus on your academic progression. I think things are significantly different to where they were 4 years ago, but we are absolutely committed to working with students' associations to help them get better and improve their voice.
Certainly seen the improvement over the last couple of years. Is that reflected in an improvement in representation for the part-time students, mature learners, etc., that Joanne had been referring to before, whose courses have been affected disproportionately in recent years?
It can can be really difficult to reach some demographics of students, and that's just that's not just a college representation issue, that's for universities as well. For example, there a lot of college courses, part-time students might come in at night, and perhaps there aren't student association representatives around then, or perhaps they're distance learning students, and so they're not around the campus actually as well. I think it's significantly better than what it was when there wasn't sabbatical officers. I probably couldn't put a figure on what the direct sort of intervention and interaction is with those, I hate the phrase hard to reach students. I don't think anyone's hard to reach. I think that there's just different methods and different ways. But those are students who we would say we don't normally have as much contact with as what perhaps we have with full-time, daytime students.
That's very much.
Thanks, Ross. Sorry, go on.
I was just wondering, I mean, I think anybody would welcome the increased ability of students to engage. And I mean, I think that element of the reform programme has been really important. But do you think there should be targets established at a college level or through government policy to address the fact that actually over this period, when you've had increased representation, there has been a reduction in student numbers in college by 41% and reduction in women in part-time places of 48%. So the irony to me is you get increased representation, but you're representing a smaller number of students. What do you think should be the next stage in addressing that?
Well, that's a very big question. Yeah, I mean, I think NES Scotland's been absolutely clear that there needs to be some kind of rebalancing. There has been a focus on full-time places, and that's right. It's right that there are opportunities for any student who wants to take them up. That has unfortunately come at the expense of part-time places, which is, you know, does disproportionately affect women, mature learners, and disabled people. We would just like to see more opportunities, more part-time places, maybe a sort of rebalancing in that focus.
What do you think can be done to address the rather dismissive approach that explains the disappearance of part-time courses as being, well, these were only hobby courses anyway?
Can I just say that one person's comment, and it's not anybody's official line, so...
But, I mean, I do think, but in terms of re-establishing the benefits of part-time courses, courses for people perhaps with learning disabilities who are able to be sustained in the community because of these courses, has there been any work done to try and analyse which of these courses actually have gone?
I think it's really difficult to... it's a narrative, I suppose, where the purpose of education is in order to get a qualification to go out for to the world of work, and actually sometimes omits the fact that education serves a whole ream of other purposes, whether that's confidence building, getting people back into just a social context of being able to interact with other people, and that's hugely valid too.
I don't want to be at all dismissive and suggest that all of these courses were hobby courses, but some of them were very short courses. And at the time of the economic downturn, there was a decision which was partly by the funding council, partly by the government, to prioritise full-time courses for young people at a time when that was needed. Now, like Vonnie, I agree, we need to constantly keep under review the balance of courses. And a lot of... There are still part-time courses existing in the college sector. There has been a rebalancing away from some very short ones. And I'm not being dismissive of these courses, but it was about prioritisation. In the decisions that we take in the Funding Council about prioritisation, students are part of that. I mean, if Vonnie and I hadn't been here today, we would have been at our Access and Inclusion Committee, where Vonnie is a member of the committee. Our Skills Committee, again, has a student member, and Vonnie is at our board meetings as an observer as well. So we do involve students in those decisions, but the changes to college provision to increase the number of full-time students and reduce the number of part-time students, without being dismissive of these courses, was about prioritising something that was needed at that time.
But would it be reasonable to say, I get prioritisation, I get that you address the challenges of particular times, if you simply do it by the length of the course, then you may be losing very important courses for people to enhance their ability to access work, while at the same time sustaining other courses that might not... I wonder if you have applied a set of criteria to... which is more subtle than simply saying if you're under 18 or if you're full-time, because it does address, and I don't know whether the college sector has looked at this, but anecdotally I'm advised that the kinds of courses that would support people to sustain people with learning disabilities in the community which don't reach, they don't come to a qualification, but they actually are critical in terms of people being able to achieve their full potential. These courses are disproportionately disappearing. If you don't know, could you give me a reassurance at least that you would look at this question so that you're not crudely getting rid of courses on the basis they don't have a qualification, when in fact, for some particular groups, they're not just nice things to have, but they're very significant in terms of people being able to be supported.
I mean, I can undertake that we will meet and give you more detail on that. But the only courses that, and this was covered in the Audit Scotland report going back to 2009, the only ones where we applied a criteria of the length of the course for not funding them in future were ones of less than 10 hours. I mean, they were very, very short courses. Not the kind of course you were talking about there.
Even if it was within 10 hours, I'm asking, is it reasonable to say, what was that course doing, and how was that enhancing somebody's skills, rather than a kind of a blanket, by definition, because it's under 10 hours, it is worthless. I don't think that's particularly rigorous way of looking at what these courses are offering.
Yeah. I'm very happy to give you more information on the courses.
So you can send the information to the committee then, John. Okay. That would be helpful. Thank you very much. Colin and then Ross.
Thank you, Mayor. I think it's probably worthwhile while we're looking at the doom and gloom in the Audit Scotland's report, and I'm very conscious we shouldn't be drifting into the Public Audit Committee's area. But I mean, the report clearly says that the college sector has continued to exceed activity targets. There's also been a comment made about women being disproportionately impacted by the termination of the short-term courses, but the report here says that gender balance is now broadly equal overall, which seems laudable. The number of students going to a positive destination is at a record 82%. That's got to be good. And also the overall percentage of full-time further education students completing their courses from 2009-10 has increased from 59% to 2014-15 when it's 64%. I mean, these are all very positive things that we need to look at as well. And, I would recognise that some students that are on very short-term courses, such as have been described, 10 hours and so on, have probably lost out on that. But I think, we do need to look at the bigger picture. And the bigger picture is whether the government is actually successfully delivering the outcomes that its policies intended to do, which it clearly appears to do.
I think we should be absolutely clear that Scotland has got a world-class education system, which we should rightly be proud of. But I really wanted to come back to that 64% successful completion figure, because actually that means that 36% of students aren't completing their course. That's a third of students who are going to college. That's a third of our arguably most vulnerable learners coming from the most disadvantaged backgrounds. A third, that's a huge number of students that aren't completing their course. I do recognise that there are significant successes that we should rightly celebrate in Scotland's education system, but that figure, that 36% of students not completing their course, isn't one of them.
To come back on that, I agree with you. I mean, it'd be wonderful if 100% of the students completed their course. I think the point I was making is there is improvement. You can argue it's not enough improvement, that it should be going further, but there is improvement. So I think we should be noting that. And the 36%, I haven't seen an analysis of whether that's students from disadvantaged backgrounds or whether it's a mix right across the community. I don't know that. It would be interesting to have that figure, actually.
Our destination survey information, we actually find out what's happened to those 36, because often it can just be that they've gone and got a job, which is not a negative outcome.
Sorry, actually, Colin has beat me too in many ways. I was wanting to look at the dropout rate and sort of what the rationale behind that would be. I suppose tying a few things together, it's maybe quite a broad question, and looking at the impact of college mergers and regionalisation, to find out more particularly from the college sector. In terms of, we've had reports from the Funding Council, we've had reports from Audit Scotland, but what criteria do you think should be in place to firmly and robustly judge the success or not of the merger programme?
Of just the merger programme?
Yeah.
I'm risk of repeating myself. I think it's really difficult just to look at the merger programme. It took place at a time of massive change.
I don't think it would be easy to disentangle just the benefits of the merger programme. But if I was to focus on just the merger programme, I think what we now have is a smaller number of colleges. Some of them are off scale. I think what that's enabled us to do is to act more cohesively as a sector and to also work more cohesively with employers. So there are definitely benefits there. We are bigger players. I think we're more influential in community planning partnerships, for example, of which colleges don't neatly fit into the regional structures of community planning partnerships, but still they're big players. So there have been benefits of the structural changes, and I suppose what it has done as well, the mergers have brought together colleges to avoid duplication of some of the courses where you had colleges side by side and competing for the same students. So there are definitely benefits there. And as the merger evaluation reports that John's already alluded to have shown savings on the pay bill of over 50 million per annum. So.
Okay, thank you very much. Ross, you were right, come in.
Yeah, just very briefly going back to the dropout figure and the third of students who don't complete, taking on board Jonah's point that many of these students have actually found themselves in a positive destination, there's a significant number, of course, who are not, and the summer months are really an acute problem for that. What is the next stage, in your view, in supporting students in that gap over summer? Because that's where the funding issue becomes its most severe.
So I think I just wanted to clarify, actually, because I knew I had it written down somewhere, it's the 64% of students who are passing their course as FE level students. The retention and the successful completion for HE level students within colleges is 71.3%, so that's quite significantly higher, and I think there's probably something in that. NES Scotland is very, very clear that the FE student support system as it stands just now is unfit for purpose. We have information that we've accrued through doing surveys to students about how students feel about applying to courses when they don't know what their income is likely to be. As an example, if you're a mature adult returner with children, you have to make the decision as to whether you're going to apply for a bursary or whether you're going to apply or whether you're going to remain on benefits if you're going to do an FE level course, which can be like really challenging to navigate if you don't know what your options are. Also, the current system for FE student support currently discriminates by age rather than by level of study. As an example, if you're doing an FE level course and you are aged up to 19, it is likely you'll be paid the EMA, the Education Maintenance Allowance, of £30 a week rather than the maintenance bursary, which is between £74 to £94 a week. That's not colleges doing anything wrong. That is a limited cash sum of money that they have to allocate between all of their FE level students, and using the EMA rather than the bursary is a way to make sure that pot is stretched further and can support more students. So certainly, as far as NUS Scotland is concerned, we've absolutely welcomed the government's commitment to a student support review. I think it's fair to say that if we were starting right now with student support system and we were designing a student support system, what we would design would look not very much like what we have just now. And I think we'll be sort of hopefully really involved in that and look forward to some really strong recommendations in the long term coming out, but certainly in the interim as well, to make sure that funding gap for college funding for FE level students is plugged.
Thanks.
If you wanted to come in briefly.
Yeah, just one final question, if I could, given this as an overview. I took Professor Nolan's earlier point that it's difficult to plan when you're getting one-year funding and you have three-year or more extended lengths of financial planning within university. But there's a budget about to come up. What pitch are you making, will you share with the committee, not necessarily today, but at some point in the autumn, what pitch are you making for funding? And I presume you're going to make it on a three-year basis, and the justification behind that? In other words, why should we give universities more money given the financial constraints the country faces?
We appreciate the financial constraints and that we've had over a long period of time. What we believe about universities is they hugely add to the prosperity of a country, to Scotland being fairer, wealthier, greener.
All sectors argue that. So.
Absolutely. In terms of the growth of the economy, we believe that that is fueled by our graduates, by graduate-level skills, and in actual fact, investing in those and beyond in master's-level skills is really important. And if you look around the world,
That's what many developing economies are doing. Universities are playing in an international stage. Whether we have five universities in the world's top 200, but it's not just those universities. We have a world-class system. So my university is not in the world top 200, but I teach 6,000 students in Hong Kong, in Singapore, in India. We play on an international field, and many countries really envy the higher education system of Scotland. What we're pitching for is that we are sustainably funded. And we've talked a lot about the Audit Scotland Colleges report. There was an Audit Scotland Higher Education report which indicated quite clearly that the sustainability of the sector is not being addressed. So funding a sustainable sector that will recover the cost of our teaching and the cost of our research, while recognising that we are in difficult times.
Okay. Thank you.
Well, maybe later. Right, okay. Tavish, finished?
Yes, thank you.
Right, yep. Thank you very much. Yep. Richard, you wanted to come in on funding and... Sorry, my apologies then. Liz.
Thank you. And can I just pick up the point? I want to ask two specific questions about funding. And can I start with research and innovation? And notwithstanding Brexit and what I believe is a very difficult situation, a very worrying situation for university research, could I just ask you about the problems with the Research Excellence Grant, which is causing some concern in that, as I understand it, that's being cut. And that is something that, in terms of the balance of the indication that you obviously have to raise as much in research funding as you possibly can for exactly the reasons you've just set out. Could you say a little bit more about this problem with the Research Excellence Grant?
The Research Excellence Grant is part of our core funding that comes from the Scottish Funding Council, and John will probably say something in a minute. And we use that to fund our facilities and various other research, generic research costs, if you like, within our universities. It is there because the funding we get for research from research councils, from charities, from European sources, they do not cover the full cost of research, and they're absolutely clear about that. And that's the dual support system, which we live and breathe every day. So it's a hugely important part of us being able to attract in. So Scotland spent probably around 280 million invested through the Reg in university research. Through that, we leveraged in up to, I think, 3 to 4 times that amount. We leveraged it in on the back of that money. So it's a very well-used investment. And what has happened with the cuts that were sustained this year was that our teaching grant took more of a cut in 16-17, and our research grant was flat cash, which was better than having a cut. But in terms of competing internationally, and research is not local anymore. Whatever you're doing, research is international. The connectivity of scientists, of problems, the societal challenges we face here are the same as many communities around the world. That's absolutely... it is pivotal that we invest in our research infrastructure and maintain that balance.
It just to re-emphasise that point, there was no cut in research grant this year. The core research grant was kept at flat cash. Now, except that, you know, in the era of inflation, that is a real terms cut, but in cash terms, it was preserved. Where there have been changes is the distribution between institutions has changed as a result of the last research assessment exercise, which had a differential outcome. Some institutions did better. Quite a lot of institutions in Scotland did very well, and that meant that they took a bigger share of what was a same size pot, and that meant some institutions didn't get as much money. But there's been no cut in the overall pot.
Can I just put everything together this morning in terms of the funding aspect? Obviously, we're looking at a situation where the Scottish Government has decreed that 20% of the intake of every Scottish university will come from disadvantaged backgrounds by 2030. And on top of that, we have issues about research funding. Professor Nolan and Mr. Kemp this morning have flagged up the issue about the supply of places. And we have, on top of that, obviously issues to do with the Brexit settlement. Can I ask you, which is a very important question, if we are to widen access successfully and not cause the difficulties that Joanne Lamont spoke about earlier in squeezing out some other students because of the cap system, Mr. Kemp, that you mentioned, we do have to have a debate about finding more money for the sector. Because as I understand it, to do all we want to do, to deliver everything that the Scottish Government set out, we have to have more places and we have to have more money. Can I ask you whether you think that's a correct direction of travel? And to come back on Tavish Scott's question, to what extent will we have to increase the funding to have that sustainable future for what is a world-class university sector?
You want me to go first? The targets for widening access are not for this year. They are in the future. The First Minister talked about a child born, I think, in 2014. So it's 2030 before we're done. So there is time for us to, over time, make adjustments to funding levels in order to achieve that. There are a number of ways in which those targets can be met. Some of the ones we've talked about this morning, about articulation and so on, mean there isn't a linear, expanding everything to exactly the same size. There are a number of ways of doing it. So while I would agree that in the long run, and I'm the interim chief executive of a funding council for both colleges and universities, and in the spending review, I want both colleges and universities to do well on that, because I think the big benefit you get from an educated population at colleges and universities, that is what drives the economy. It's about the people and the innovation, but largely the people that come out of universities that makes a difference. I'm not going to sit here and say exactly what the number is we would want in the spending review and what that should be over the next 15 or 20 years, but there are a number of ways of doing it that can equalise participation without necessarily expanding the system to the highest level that we have at the moment.
Could you just expand on that, Mr. Kemp? Because, if we are to ensure that 20% come from disadvantaged backgrounds and not have a disproportionate effect on existing students, surely, by definition, that means that there has to be more places.
I don't think I denied that. But I'm saying that it doesn't. It's not a linear. You need to expand it up to the exactly the same kind with everyone doing 6 years at school and then getting five hires and going in to do a full 4 year course. If we get the developing the young workforce work operating properly and different learner journeys, not everyone will take that route. And arguably, that we don't want 60% of the population taking that route. That's the economy needs a variety of different people with higher education experience, and that's the importance of linking the developing the young workforce agenda with the widening access agenda. We need to produce an output from our universities and colleges, which is what the economy needs.
But forgive me, Joanne Lamont made the point very eloquently earlier that we know of students who are extremely well qualified, who are finding it increasingly difficult to get into university, which is a good thing in terms of the competitive edge that universities have, but that is surely not a good thing for the Scottish economy's future.
I mean, from our perspective, it is a conversation that it is a political choices about how you fund a higher education system. And if we are to increase places around to hit the 20% target without there being a change in demand, then and in a fixed cap system, there is only one obvious conclusion, which is that some people will be displaced. There may be other choices that are developed for those people. They may wish them, so demand may change. But that is the reality of where I see we are now. I suppose a key question for me is that we need to make sure that the teaching we are doing and providing and in that rich research environment in universities is properly funded. And what I would be very sad to see is any erosion of the unit of resource for teaching. Our tuition fee has been static for 6 or 7 years now. So I think there's a whole conversation to be had there across the education system about how we prioritise and what is right for Scotland.
Did you want to come in briefly?
Thank you. I will indeed ask a question about funding after all. Just in terms of Brexit and all the debate taking place in the media and think pieces, etc., and evidence to various committees, what monitoring is taking place over the impact of Brexit on further and higher education at the moment in terms of your own responsibilities? And secondly, I've been hearing, but I don't have any evidence for this, that the consortiums for research are being put together in Europe that are now missing out UK institutions because of, you know, Brexit. Is that the case? Do you have any examples? Is that something you're monitoring very closely?
Yes, and we have heard these examples as well. But often, and the challenge at the moment is, we have heard the anecdotally these examples of people putting together research proposals and people from British universities being less likely to be involved. But that's in advance of anyone knowing, you know, what the arrangements will be in the future. And so some of that is in the realm of quite difficult to guess the full impact. So there are a whole range of unanswered questions on Brexit, which, you know, nobody knows the answer to at the moment. We have been working to sort of look at the potential impacts on Scottish universities and on Scotland colleges, because there are, you know, some courses and colleges that are funded through European money. There are implications for students from the rest of Europe who study in Scotland, and what will the impact of that, what will the numbers be in the long run. There are impacts on potential research funding. In many of these, we do not know the answer yet. We know the potential impacts. We have, you know, looked at the amounts of money involved, and they are substantial. But we don't yet know, you know, when it will happen. We don't know what the rules will be on some of these European research funds, and we don't know the outcome for European students studying in Scotland. So there are a number of unknowns. We are working quite closely with the government and with the sectors and trying to reduce those unknowns, but they are still unknowns at the moment.
Before the others come in, can I just ask, is it therefore your understanding that at the moment there are research proposals and bids being put in place in Europe where European universities and institutions are now excluding British institutions?
I have heard anecdotally that from universities, yes.
I have heard anecdotally, I don't have the evidence base, of perhaps not quite as much as, but where a UK or Scottish person was a lead, actually now being put into being a co-applicant, you know, because, well, just in case, we don't know what's going to happen. I think I would agree with John, the impact, I mean, who knows, and it's going to be some time. But a really important thing for us is where we can to give certainty to people. So we really welcomed in our sector the speed at which the Scottish Government came out and said to clarify the situation on EU student, their fee status for 16-17, and also the very reassuring messages that came out about how much we value EU staff nationals. I mean, I had many of my staff come and say to me, it was really good to hear that. I know we don't know the outcome, but at least we're appreciated and valued. But there is an area that we are trying to seek clarity on, which is around the EU students' fee status for 17-18. Our admissions, it was my point about the long time scale, our admissions opened yesterday. For UCAS. So in my prospectus, I have, as do all the universities, in their prospectuses that students are applying against, there will be the same fee status as for Scotland, i.e. EU students don't pay fees in Scotland. That is there now, and we in the universities are having real concern, is that some kind of pre-contractual arrangement? Do we admit them? On what basis do we admit them? And so we are seeking an early resolution or an early statement about the status, not the long term, because clearly at some point we will be moving out, but to help us plan and continue to attract students and to help us plan for the future, an early statement on the fee status of 17-18 students. And actually our conservatoire closes, most of its admissions have to be in early October, and admissions for medicine, dentistry and veterinary medicine. So that kind of reassurance where it's possible, not for long term, to help us transition would be most welcome.
if I can just pick up on that as well, and similar to Professor Nolan, NUS Scotland absolutely welcomed the speed at which the Scottish Government came out with that assurance. One thing that we're not entirely clear on is what the assurance will be for students who don't perhaps follow the linear route of starting university in first year and doing a four-year degree. There may well be students from an EU background who are starting their educational journey in college, perhaps at an NC level, perhaps even below that, and whose journey through education, if they want to progress through to get to attain a degree, may actually be 6 or 7 years or perhaps longer. And so some clarity on what that guarantee will mean for students who are perhaps not taking that traditional route through education would be very much welcomed.
The points that have been raised about impacting on the university sector apply equally to the college sector. It impacts on our funding, European funding, it impacts on our staff, and it impacts on our students.
Off the back of that question that Richard just asked, and we've talked about internationalisation, you've talked about attracting international students. We'll all be aware that there's a post-study visa pilot happening at the moment, and that Scottish universities were excluded from that pilot, as were Welsh universities, Northern Ireland universities. I want to ask what effect that potentially has in disadvantaging potentially Scottish universities in attracting international students. But also I want to ask if Scottish universities were asked to, were consulted on this pilot, were they asked to put applications in to be part of this pilot, or was there any kind of consultation period at all in this decision by the UK government?
No, I was not aware of it. I heard it from a colleague when it was announced. I saw it in our press. So I was not aware about it. I believe universities were chosen on the basis of visa refusal rate. I'm not quite sure because I'm not quite sure. I believe it was on that basis, but it came as a shock to us.
And what impact do you think that's going to have on you attracting international students?
Well, given that it's only four universities, it's not clear to me what kind of impact it will have, and it is a quite limited trial. But the broader issue of students and immigration policy is the one that is impacting on our ability to recruit and impacting hard.
Over the last 10 years or so, the number of international students in Scottish universities has risen by about 50%, but it's kind of plateaued in the last 4 or 5 years, and that will be because of the tightening up of the visas.
The numbers have absolutely plummeted on international fronts. It's down about 75%, so although the numbers are relatively small, the proportional impact is massive.
And what impact is that having on your funding? I mean, obviously, these are fee-paying students as well.
Yeah, I mean, certainly the college sector is that we get our funding. We need to bring in other sources of funding. And so, therefore, anything that impacts on any funding streams has got a negative impact. So it's not good.
As John said, we have been growing, but we have plateaued, and we've seen some countries plummet. I mean, students from India coming have dropped by over a half in the last 3 or 4 years because of changes. And I'd just like to make clear, we want good students to come, and we really appreciated the post-study work, the Fresh Talent Initiative that was here in Scotland. We believed it benefits Scottish businesses. So we want students who are here by right. But the future is going to be very, very challenging. And the Audit Scotland report said, well, diversify your income streams. Well, we are trying hard, and it's becoming increasingly difficult with the myriad of changes that occur to immigration policy on almost a monthly basis.
Thank you for that.
Any more questions, Joy? No? Okay, thank you very much. Daniel?
Yes, I mean, I was... It's been partly covered off by the line of questioning regarding EU funding, but I mean, given that just under 10% of students in Scottish universities are non-UK EU students, and given the issues, I mean, has there been any communication from the Scottish Government about the status of 17, 18 applications. And am I right in my understanding that some universities are actually having to underwrite the funding for those themselves? And what would be the potential impact of that?
We've had discussion highlighting that we would like an early statement on the status so as we can plan, but we've not had
anything so far yet.
No.
I mean, and what might be the consequences to Scottish universities, you know, if they're left covering those costs themselves?
Well, obviously significant. It also rearranges, I mean, to actually... We have our prospectuses approved now for the next round of recruiting. So that ability to plan is really, really challenging on this basis.
So it'd be fair to say that the university is really being left in limbo.
We need a decision.
Yeah.
We need a decision one way or another.
Could I just also very quickly ask you, just rounding on some of the points about sustainability that you raised. Again, the Audit Scotland report highlighted very clearly that there's been an 8% decline in real terms of the tuition fee paid to Scottish universities. And again, by 2016-17, there will have been an 8% cut in the teaching grant. Would you classify that as a sustainable level of funding?
Well, obviously, it depends what happens in the next bit, in our discussions that are going on now about the year ahead, and particularly... I mean, we appreciate the difficulty, you know, the financially difficult environment, but for us it's about long-term sustainability. You know, we're working with the government to kind of be a part of a short-term fix, but we can't go on underfunding of the sector as it is.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I've just got one final question for the panel. It's on the Higher Education and Research Bill. Could you tell us what you think the impact of this legislation will be for Scotland, including any risks for teaching or research?
I think there are two main areas of impact. One is on teaching quality and how that's measured. There is a proposal in the bill to set up a teaching excellence framework in England. As there are a substantial number of students from the rest of the UK come to Scottish universities will want comparability with the teaching excellence framework at some point. We have a separate quality system in Scotland, which we intend to continue to have a separate quality system in Scotland. So the issue will be how you marry these two things together, comparability with the teaching excellence framework in England with our quality enhancement framework in Scotland. And there is work ongoing to do that. I was down in London yesterday giving evidence at the committee stage of the bill. There is work going on that aspect of it, but we're quite clear that, you know, Scotland will continue to have a distinctive quality system. There are also implications on research funding, where the creation of UKRI, which will merge some of HEFCE's, our equivalent body in England's research funding, with the research councils and create a body which has both an England-specific role in terms of the former HEFCE funding and a UK-wide role with the research council funding, is something that we want to make sure that Scottish universities are not disadvantaged in any way, that body operates properly as a UK body, and that Scottish universities continue to receive what is a fairly substantial amounts, around £250 million a year from the research councils as part of a UK-wide body.
I think it's fair to say that NUS has got significant concerns, and I'd be happy to submit the documentation that NUS has prepared and sent to Westminster for consideration, if that would be useful to you. I think... In regards to the teaching excellence framework, we've got quite grave concerns that the metrics as proposed don't align really very well with the Scottish system and the students as partners approach that Scottish institutions have taken and developed very well. We have concerns about the Office for Students, which is as it stands just now has no guaranteed student representation on its board, which to me means the Office for Students is an oxymoron. There have been a number of amendments tabled to the bill which seek to address some of the major concerns that NUS has, but as it stands right now, I think gravely concerned is probably the position I would say NUS, and that's not just NUS Scotland, that's NUS as an entirety, has with regards to the proposals.
Thank you, Monica. Professor.
I absolutely just agree with John's points about the areas that will give us rise to concern and that we're working on around the TEF and also around the UKRI, the reconfiguration of the research landscape to make sure that Scotland has a voice in that, a clear voice.
Thank you. I was just going to ask on that point. I'll come to you in a minute, Mr. Ruttles. But how do we get the Scottish Government to be able to oversee this as well, because, or the Scottish Parliament, because at this stage it's only accountable, the UKRI is only accountable to Westminster ministers.
Yeah, well, we've put in quite strongly that we would have representation on the board, and where we can, we have flagged this the whole time. It's not just Scotland, it's Wales
of course.
Northern Ireland. So we are pushing hard. Our concern that having Research England in the middle of this, that there needs to be a financial firewall between that and the research councils that actually fund a lot of our research. And Scotland is hugely successful in accessing research council funding, far more than our share of population would determine. So we've lobbied hard on that and trying to get the UKRI board to have our representation from Scotland.
Thank you. Strauss.
I don't have anything to contribute further.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, in that case, can I just thank you all for your time and your very useful evidence. Thank you again. End of the first session, we'll have a short break and then we'll come back to the next session of witnesses, panel of witnesses.
think we'll just start with the witnesses for panel two. Can I thank you very much for your attendance. And in front of us we have Mark Smith, the head of Early Career Strategy Standard Life, Gareth Williams, head of policy, Scottish Council for Development and Industry, Helen Martin, Assistant Secretary, Scottish Trade Union Congress, and Gordon McGuinness, Director of Industry and Enterprise Networks, Skill Development Scotland. Can I thank you for your attendance this morning, and can I kick off by asking a question about modern apprenticeships, and if you don't mind, Mr. Smith, I'd like to ask you about some of the work that Standard Life are doing around the challenges and potential benefits of extending the number of apprenticeships, and others can come in after.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I mean, we've done a lot, I guess, in the early career space over the last 3 or 4 years. Apprenticeships, formal apprenticeships in the modern apprenticeship framework is probably the least volume aspect that we've done, and most of our focus has been still on graduate, but sort of early careers, entry levels from school leavers, as opposed to formal apprenticeships. We still do over 300 in the last 5 or 6 years. But it's been quite an interesting shift just in the last 3 years. The vast majority, almost 90% of the actual modern apprenticeships we've done have been done by those aged under 25. For a long time, the apprenticeship route was something which was available to existing staff members to further their career and their development, as opposed to targeted specifically at entry-level roles. So we've done a lot. For us, the apprenticeship route is very much, it has to be aligned to the skills we need as a business. So if there is an apprenticeship available which will enhance what we do, we will offer it. That it's quite as straightforward as that. And we've been very pleased to work on the foundation level apprenticeship, speaking to Skill Development Scotland about graduate level apprenticeships. So for us, if we can focus on those areas that are really of interest to us, we will be supportive. And if that means taking more on, delighted to do it. If that means that we reduce the number of graduates that we take to take more apprentices, that's something that we will look at, because it's about getting the right skills blend that we need to move forward. So very happy to look at any solution that takes our skill set forward.
Yeah, why did you have the kind of large increase in the type of apprentices you're taking? What drove that?
Well, if we go back 6 years, we didn't employ anybody aged under 21 in the business. So, you know, we're not going to be a sustainable business for another 200 years if we don't, you know, reach out to our communities and give young people first career opportunities. So we started a school leaver program that was not tied to any skills training or any formal accreditation. It was just an opportunity to give a formal structured work experience to young people who deserved it and who were, you know, more than talented, irrespective of background qualifications or anything else. So it was driven by two things. One, you know, the realization that we would, you know, we didn't have these numbers, and that was a failure on many levels, and a determination to do the right thing, but also to build a skills base which would take us forward. So that was a start point for us. Literally less than half of 1% aged under 25, going back to 2010. So that was the driver, one school leaver program, and since then a refocus on traineeships. Investment 2020 now comes into our investment operation. Apprenticeships, foundation, graduate, the suite of early careers program has started from what we call our LMA guarantee scheme, 6 months paid internship, and now cuts right across the business. And, you know, for us, it's really important we've got the skills, you know, to move the business forward. We've done the right thing. We've tried to connect with communities and try and be as diverse as we can in our employment practices from lots of different groups, both school leavers, you know, ethnicity, you know, whatever. We try and target groups wherever we can. And it's exciting to see what we've done, and I'm delighted to take the role now that looks to how we can join up our internal programs from school leaver right the way through to postgraduate, and how we internationalise the frameworks that we've established here, which is, you know, be open and diverse. Because, you know, for us, the prospects of having a business which is just, ageing and not having the right requisite skills, that's not building a sustainable business.
Just one final question. What's the sustainability in terms of how many continue right through the programme or how many drop off?
Yeah, so it depends on the programme. So if I think about our school leaver, our guarantee scheme, 70% stay employed with us at the end of their paid 6 months. So we bring them in, give them the living wage development programme, and, you know, just under 70% stay with us, and 28% go on to either employment or higher education. So we only have 2%. who don't go into a positive destination. Our graduates, we've got over a 90% retention rate. Our apprentices, again, it's at 90%. And we've got lots of anecdotes of people who've sort of progressed from an apprenticeship or a trainee scheme and are still with us. So really high retention rates. A lot of the programmes are still quite young. So we've still got some time to see a lot of the benefits flying through the business. But it fills me with real pride when you see someone who's been with us like on a programme like Career Ready, for example, where they work with us, they're mentored by one of our staff for 2 years. They come, they get a paid internship in the summer. When they leave education, they apply to our school leaver programme. Then in that 6 months, they then become a modern apprentice. And now they're working towards professional qualifications. And that's, over the last 5 years. And that to us has been the power of unlocking kind of a latent talent stream, which we just weren't tapping into, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, we were just starting. So, the transformation of our age profile is extraordinary. I mean, to come back to that point earlier, half of 1% age under 25, at the start of last week, that number was now at 7.3%. So we've worked hard, and we're pleased with what we've done, but we also acknowledge that actually the potential internally now is massive about how we make sure that talent that we've recruited progresses and takes our business forward.
Very much. Just like to go on to the other members of the panel and ask them again about the challenges and potential benefits, and also the role of employers, third sector, educational establishments in delivering apprenticeships, SDS, etc. as well. Mr. McGuinness, on you go.
Pick up on that. Thanks very much, and thanks for the invitation to come along this morning. What Mark outlines is really a model of what we've been encouraging many businesses to do. Too many companies have got out of the way of just recruiting and inducting young people into the business, private and public sector. So the promotion and development of the modern apprenticeship, and as Mark referenced, the wider apprenticeship family, foundation and graduate apprenticeships, is something that we're very keen to promote further to businesses. Scotland has had a strong apprenticeship model, a stable policy environment for apprenticeships, and I think that's been welcomed by employers. A commitment that all apprentices were employed, and Vonnie quoted some statistics earlier on. Those are minimum level statistics, so the apprenticeship rates are set as part of the national minimum wage at a UK level. Many employers in Scotland will pay significantly above that, particularly into the private sector, and most public sector employers will be paying the living wage in terms of their apprenticeships. Not all, but many are. Employers in the private sector recognise the need to compete for young people, so that also influences their wage rates. And somebody like Scottish Water, when you take into account their investment in training, it will cost them around £120,000, combining wages and their top-up training over and above what SDS give them as a contribution to take a young person through their apprenticeship. So it's not an insignificant investment that they are making in a young person, but as Mark says, they're getting the right skills and the right fit for their business. We see the introduction of the apprenticeship levy, which was introduced, and government officials will say it has been imposed in Scotland and other devolved nations by the UK government as an opportunity to take that apprenticeship investment further. Skills Development Scotland has formed the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board. It's chaired by our chairman, but has a large representation of senior business people, good gender balance as well, I may add, from across the business community. It met for its second time yesterday in Glasgow. Got input around the quality and standards that we plan to undertake. Had engagement with further senior officials from Scottish Government. Minister Jamie Hepburn met our employer engagement group 2 weeks ago, and had a presentation from Foundation apprenticeship participants in engineering. And the discussion earlier on around vocational or academic routes, they had two young people there, and from their experience through the Foundation apprenticeship, one was targeting a university programme, another one was looking for the vocational route back into the workplace. So I think it's an exciting time for us, a lot of work. We've got an extensive programme of engagement with many of the levy-paying companies that will be in Scotland, trying to get them in their terms levy-ready, making sure that they've got a good awareness of vocational routes. that they can tap into the latent skills programme or skills talents that, that Mark referred to. So it's so an important time for us, but one, we've got good engagement, both with, you touched around the provider networks and third sector, good engagement there, strong. So there'll be a Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board that will be supported by an employer engagement group, a standards and quality group, and a group that's going to specifically looking at the quality based issues, and that's backed up by our current MA Equality Action Plan as well.
Thank you very much. Does anybody have any comment? Mr. Williams?
The Modern Apprenticeship Programme is one of the skills programmes that our members report most positively on. And we welcome the plans to increase the number of starts in this Parliament. And that's based on their own experience, but also on the evidence that there is internationally linking apprenticeships with higher productivity. We think that the Scottish model, which emphasises quality, is one that we need to protect and sustain, rather than moving towards more of a volume approach, and certainly welcome the comments that have been made by both witnesses so far around diversity and looking at gender stereotyping in particular areas. That's one that we would endorse. We welcome the introduction of graduate level apprenticeships. Many of our employer members want to make that link between work and learning at those higher level skills, and we also welcome the introduction of foundation apprenticeships, and we hope that over time those can be made available to children in every school, young people in every school. But at the same time, we recognise that there are challenges, for example, within rural areas, and the apprenticeship programme is not going to be suitable for all. It's got to be industry-led, and we need to look for particular solutions in some areas, as I say, including rural areas.
Yes, I think to echo a lot of what's been said by the other panel members. We are very supportive of the apprenticeship scheme in Scotland. We think it's, as other people have said, very good quality, and that's really one of the key strengths about it, the fact that we have defended the status of apprenticeships as employed by employers and paid at a decent rate, and unions argue for the living wage for apprenticeships, and we do achieve that in many instances. We have some concerns around the sort of some of the equality aspects of the apprenticeship system. There is still clear gender segregation in between the frameworks, which I think SDS are doing a huge amount of work on, and we are continuing to sort of prioritise changing that profile and making sure that people get the right opportunity to work, and that gender segregation isn't maintained in our economy through the apprenticeship system. We're also concerned about the numbers of disabled workers who get access to apprentices, and there are some quite simple things I think we can do around supporting the trainers who deliver the frameworks and understanding how you make reasonable adjustments, how you would support a disabled student that could potentially help that in going forward. We are equally concerned about the numbers of BME people taking up apprenticeships, and we think that that's, again, more work could be focused on that. We're very supportive of graduate level apprenticeships. We think that's a move in the right direction, and we do want to see these being used to bring people into high level sustainable careers and really good quality opportunities for workers. In terms of foundation apprenticeships, we are supportive of the concept of bringing people from schools into workplaces, and we think it was a good innovation in that respect. We have some concerns about the fact that a foundation apprenticeship is not employed and not paid, so it is a departure from the employed and paid status from the apprenticeship scheme. We can kind of see some of the arguments that people are using for why that is the case, but we think it's very, very important that it doesn't start to erode the employed and paid status in the wider apprenticeship scheme, and that the young people who are in foundation apprenticeships are not being exploited within the workplace, and that there has been a proper consideration of how foundation apprenticeships link with apprenticeships and link with kind of minimum wage requirements that come around the apprentice, because as Gordon said earlier, that is employment law from Westminster that has a minimum wage rate for apprenticeships, and simply calling something a foundation apprenticeship doesn't take away that need to pay the minimum wage. So there are some practical issues there, and we think that it's very, very important that we design a skill system that supports young people into work and gives them access to really good quality opportunities, and also just makes sense within the wider employment context.
Liz, you've got a couple of questions about the penance. Do you want to come in here? Right, okay, sorry. Joanne, would you like to come in and then we'll
It was Joanne. Specifically on this issue of equality of access. I wonder, I know that disability organisations put a number on the level of involvement of people with disabilities in apprenticeships. I wonder if you can give us figures on that. And secondly, if I could ask SDS, to what extent you're working with NUS on these issues, and perhaps you could indicate what specifically you're doing around addressing the question of segregation, because I think Helen Martin is absolutely right. The apprenticeships are in danger of reinforcing an inequality that's already there, but what specifically have you done to respond to those disability groups who really highlighted the very, very low numbers of people with disabilities accessing apprenticeships?
I'll come back just so I'm rock solid in some of the statistics in terms of participation levels. What we have done in terms of our action plan, and we've done a lot of work over the last 2 years, and I think that's been reflected, Helen sits in our group, is actually work with a number of the representative groups, so BMIS, Close the Gap, Engender, Capability Scotland, Glasgow Disability Alliance, and Glasgow Centre for Inclusive Learning are just some of the groups that I have worked with. We've targeted issues around disabled young people, gender balance related activity, the numbers of black and ethnic minorities that are within it, but also care leavers are an important group in terms of their equality of access to the labour market. We've developed an action plan in conjunction with our partners, a 5-year plan, measurable with smart targets attached to that. And that's where we've received £500,000 from government in terms of the investment programme to actually initiate those issues. So there's been a lot of development projects with the actual specialist groups that have delivered it so that we can get learning. And as Helen said, actually share that learning and understanding with and build capacity within our network of providers. A big focus on to employers as well, and trying to communicate more to them about the positive aspects and the abilities that disabled people have, rather than potentially the jaundiced views about what they can't do as opposed to what they can do. So I said a kind of 5-year programme that's touched on, as I said, issues around areas like STEM, related activity, big projects with the Institute of Physics and Gender and others to actually drive that activity forward. One of the things we have found around disabilities is around the disparity in terms of self-declaration of when somebody is disabled and whether or not. And there has been a tendency for individuals to withhold that information and perhaps not show that to employers or training providers when they're making applications. And that's an important one, because we've got resources that we can then deliver where we have an awareness that the young people are disabled to support them in the workplace. So it's a kind of key aspect for us, but it's and working across partners to look at the definitions of disability as well, and coming up with some agreed ones across the sector.
Have you got the figures currently for the number of people with disabilities who have accessed apprenticeships in the last
Them for you. I'll have them in my back here. Okay. If
maybe I'm not creating a hierarchy of discrimination here, and I recognise that there are particular issues around job segregation in terms of women in work. But are there specific things that disability organisations have highlighted to you round the very low figures? And to what extent are you able to take that as a separate stream of work from just a general issue around attitudes and inequalities in terms of you know, it can't simply be the attitude of a young person or maybe not declaring. There must be fundamental things that are barriers. If the numbers are in my understanding, are very small.
The numbers, they statistically are, and if you just, if maybe somebody else wants to pick up, I'll come back with the detail of that for you. Okay.
On the specific point about this, disabled people getting access to apprenticeships, our Disabled Workers Committee raised some issues around this very point, in that they were hearing reports that one of the big barriers for disabled workers was that the training provider themselves didn't have enough understanding of disability equality and how to make reasonable adjustments to support the young person through the entire scheme. So it wasn't so much the employer that was the problem, it was the training provider's understanding of how you would make a reasonable adjustment that was causing a barrier, which in some ways is extremely worrying, because I mean that shouldn't be happening within the system. But the other element of that is that because those training providers are commissioned by SDS, there's quite a simple institutional fix in that you can insist on better understanding and outcomes for disabled workers within the contract. Whereas the impact that you can have on employers sometimes is more challenging. So in some ways, if that is what is happening within the system, there should be things that we should be able to do this year and next year that correct that issue.
In terms of its significance, we already know, for example, people with visual impairments, phenomenal numbers of people who are unable to access work. And then we have a debate about the extent to which support people with disabilities in terms of the benefit system, which is really, really important. But the other bit of it is there are things that are happening in the system that are actively stopping people working. So, you know, in terms of it being a priority for the work of SDS, it is to really understand we ought not to be having trainers who don't get this, but also the broader significance of it in terms of the potential of people with disabilities to work isn't just really about fairness within apprenticeships, it's a broader fairness about the world of work itself.
I don't disagree. So the work that we had undertaken around the 14-15 starts for modern apprenticeships, only 0.41% had actually self-declared in terms of having a disability within the programme. We undertook an exercise with our training providers, and those numbers increased to 3% in terms of understanding that negotiation with the young people in the programme. When we went back and analysed their school records, then if you look at equal cohorts, then something in the region of 12.5% have been recorded as having disabilities. So we do have a range of measures which will both target the young people, will target employers, and those within the education system, particularly that transition period. So we have a data hub structure, which is a shared record system with all education institutions in terms of schools, with colleges, with DWP, ourselves and SAS. And it's using that type of, big data in terms of analysing and understanding where young people are in the system, and then getting career coaches and careers advisors working with them, and then linking them into our training organisations as well to try and pull more young people with disabilities through into the training system.
Within the programme?
We've got targets, and I'll send you a copy of our 5-year action plan, and I think we'd be more than happy to come back with some of the specialist people on our team and sit down and have a more detailed session. But we've got a published 5-year action plan, and it's a real focus for our work and with our training organisations as well, and the targets within that.
But with respect, those targets aren't working. So would you look at the consideration of quotas? That is, you're going to identify a certain amount of money that you've got funded to deal with apprenticeship, which will only go to people with disabilities?
We have a number of incentives already which are target-driven in terms of wage incentives to help young people into the workplace. So those targets exist and we'll be measured against those.
But you wouldn't ring-fence part of your budget?
Yes, it's already there.
It is ring-fenced. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, Tavish, did you want to come in briefly?
No, dairy altogether. Right. So,
okay. May I ask about the apprenticeship levy? My feedback from businesses is that very much hope that this is an additional source of income, and secondly, that it correctly dovetails with lots of the other programmes that are already happening. Could I ask you what your feeling is? I think the Scottish Government, UK Government, are consulting about how that money should be allocated just now. Could you give us your views on what you think a good allocation would be, not in terms of the amount, but in terms of how it should be done? And secondly, I noticed that Scottish Government's made the comment that it's possible that this undermines the sort of Scottish aspect, the discrete Scottish aspect of apprenticeships. Could you comment on that? So, two questions there.
I'll pick up. From our perspective, so I've met now with Mr. Hepburn a few times, Jamie Hepburn, Minister, in relation to business consultation. So there has been a significant consultation at a Scottish Government level, and I think that's been appreciated both by individual organisations and by the business representation organisations like CBI. I think there's a frustration at the government level about the lack of detail about how funds will come to Scotland. Are they ring-fenced? Are they part of Barnett formula? The Scottish Government has consulted the consultation exercise closed last week, and it prompted six questions, and those were around broadly as the government's ambition of 30,000 MAs by 2020 around the right level, or should it be more, should it be less? Should foundation and apprenticeships potentially be part of the levy system? A question there around more flexible use of the levy in terms of workplace training and support out with the apprenticeship programme, and a question around should funds, some of the funds be used to support young people into work around employability programmes. So haven't had the outputs from that exercise. Some of the concerns that we've had from employers who have a cross-border operation, north and south, are concerned, and they want a programme of activity that isn't too dissimilar north and south of the border. And you asked about the English system. So England have set a target of 3 million apprentices over the course of the UK Parliament. Scotland's equivalent, if they were to follow that percentage, would be something like 60,000. And I think the gut feel from us is that's simply too many. It's kind of chasing numbers. We have an expansion plan to take it to 30,000 by 2020, and that's undertaking a fair amount of work with industry bodies, looking at sectors within a regional basis, engineering, for example, where we can identify clusters of engineering companies, but the percentage of apprentices in that area are lower than we would anticipate, so very much kind of targeted marketing campaign. And then off the back of things like foundation apprenticeships, you know, would you have a growth programme as well that would complement that? So I don't know if I'm fully answering your question. There's a lack of detail at present. And I think a recognition, the English UK government had said a pound in meant a pound out in terms of an employer. Some fairly complex structures appearing in terms of if a levy payer was wanting to use that within their supply chain. I think it comes across potentially as fairly bureaucratic.
The time scale for a decision being made about the allocation?
It would be best, I would imagine, to ask a government official in terms of time scales. The consultation exercise has been concluded. I understand that the announcements will be made around November time, but that will be for the minister to decide.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Liz. Thank you. Thank you. Diana?
I'd just really like to follow up. I mean, I think, but first and foremost, I mean, I think it's good to hear the widespread recognition of the importance of apprenticeships, and certainly the committee last week visited Stirling Community Enterprise, which I think really kind of demonstrated for certainly Fulton and myself just the kind of the power that apprenticeships done well can do in terms of delivering opportunities. But I mean, I think despite all the good work that's gone on in Scotland, I mean, I think there were only 8 months away from the apprenticeship levy coming in. And I mean, could I maybe suggest that Mr. McGuinness, you're being slightly diplomatic in your language about the reaction from employers. I mean, I think that certainly over the summer I've heard things such as saying that there needs to be clarity and that there's serious risks. And these are some of the things that employers are saying to me. I mean, are we ready for the apprenticeship levy? And if not, what has to happen to make sure that we are ready?
I think government ministers themselves would express a degree of frustration about the amount of detail that is available from at a UK level. On top of that, I think there's been a number of changes made to the UK Commission for Employment and Skills, which undermines actual support structures around things like national occupational standards, for example, which have greater importance in Scotland because much of the SQA's portfolio, for example, is built on national occupational standards, and these were structures that were designed at UK level. Sure. So colleagues have been taking some actions to address this. Sure. For businesses, if you're an engineering company and going to make a commitment, then that's a four-year commitment that you're making to a young person to take them through their apprenticeship. So there is issues there in terms of what that future financial landscape will look like. It's not within our control, and at this stage would not appear to be in the control of Scottish ministers in terms of waiting for information from UK.
Can I maybe put this, the same point to Mr. Smith, to Mr. Williams and Ms. Martin, just kind of, in a sense, Ms. McGuinness is sort of sitting in the middle and waiting for things to happen. I mean, what's your feeling about, you know, the risks and indeed opportunities from the apprenticeship levy, and what needs to happen between now and April?
The majority of our members would be not opposed to the principle of an apprenticeship levy. The biggest concern has been around the lack of clarity, and that's principally been at a UK level, and I think there's a degree of sympathy with the Scottish Government's position. That said, the Scottish Government did earlier this year go around and speak to a couple of hundred businesses, and the output of that certainly wasn't clear within the consultation that was then issued over the summer, with a very short time for businesses to respond. So that obviously is another concern. Gordon's already highlighted some of the issues, the concern about the Scottish model, how the funding will come back to Scotland and back to businesses, the cross-border issues for businesses, the impact on existing levies like the CITB levy, and the future of industry support for those to continue. Concerns around the thresholds and whether those will be linked to inflation or changed if there is continuing pressures on public sector budgets, bringing a lot more businesses into the system. And obviously we've been picking up issues in specific sectors like public sector, sectors of the economy that have different models of training like the legal sector. Those businesses that perhaps place a lot of temporary workers in other businesses and therefore wouldn't necessarily offer their own training schemes. And those businesses that perhaps have fluctuations in terms of their work, fluctuations in terms of their workforce as well, and the point of the year that these calculations would be made and might draw some of those businesses into the system, and there would have to be ways of addressing that. So I go back to the lack of clarity as the overriding concern. There is going to be significant money, we understand, coming to Scotland, and as has been said already, I think businesses want to be able to have a strong voice in how that is spent. And they want to see strong evidence of additionality in relation to the plans that were already in place.
I think from our point of view, we see the levy as actually a tremendous opportunity. We are very supportive of the introduction of the levy because we think it is important that employers take a really strong role in providing skills within their own workplaces. And we think that that's something that has maybe been lacking to a certain extent in the past. And what the levy is doing already, we can see, is increasing the interest of employers in getting involved in training and skills policy and having a strong voice within how this money might be spent. So We think that actually it's a really good opportunity to put in some proper infrastructure around the training and skills environment as envisaged by the Wood Review. So the SAB, the Scottish Advisory for Apprenticeship Board, this, whatever those letters stand for, that board I think will be absolutely crucial going forward, and it will be an opportunity for employers and unions to sit together and to talk about, you know, what apprenticeships should look like, what the numbers should be in different sectors, how that should kind of work. And we think that previously there wasn't really an opportunity to do that because it just wasn't getting the same level of buy-in from individual employers, whereas now there is a high level of interest. There is potentially some dangers within the system about whether this will just suck up the training budget of employers and just means that suddenly apprentices become the only thing for training and lifelong learning available to employees. And we think that we really have to guard against that within the system because it can't be the only thing that we do to train people. There has to be a good range of options for a range of workers in a range of circumstances. So whether you fund that all from the levy or whether you fund the levy does a distinct thing and then there's other money drawn down for lifelong learning or for other training, or employers are expected to do that in addition, I mean, that's all up for discussion. And a lot of where you would draw the lines in this is about what is the level of funding that we receive from Westminster. So until that question is answered in terms of the level of funding, it's very difficult to set up to understand how much the levy is going to provide in your education and training system as a whole, whether it's going to stretch the foundation apprenticeships, whether it's going to stretch out for unemployed workers, whether it's going to stretch to the workplace as a whole. You know, all of that is dependent on how much money is actually within the system. But we do know and we are clear that we need a training and skills system that can do all of these things in and fits together nicely, and the levy has to play a role in that. So, I mean, in an ideal world, we'll be able to meet this challenge, and we'll be able to maintain the best aspects of the Scottish system, which is the quality of the apprenticeships, the employed and paid status, the employer and union involvement, and the industry standards that underpin all the training. But there are like quite serious technical issues that need to be resolved within this going forward as well.
Clarity would be nice. You know, because the sooner that we know, the sooner we can make some plans and some provision. We know how much it's going to cost us, so we know that there's a cash amount that will go out. We also know that we're not going to be able to reclaim a great deal of that. It's going to go, and hopefully it will go, and it will feed, you know, necessary skills development and evolution. That's okay. We're comfortable with that. We think in principle it's a very, very good thing. We are cautious of this chasing volume. You know, let's just go for a target and let's just have X number of tens or hundreds of thousands of apprenticeships. If, you know, they're into spaces that aren't needed and they're not kind of meeting the demands of business and employers, you know, what are we actually training and preparing our young people for if they're not for real jobs with decent wages at the end of it? So for us, you know, nobody wants to pay the same money twice. So we're already investing a lot of stuff in pre-employment. We're investing in our own trainees and graduates. And that's because, you know, we need those skills as a business, and we get that. My fear is that someone, you know, another part of the, you know, the fiscal process says, well, we're paying this money every year. Well, why are we paying for all these trainees and interns? Because the money's going out in this levy. So justify why you spend it. So currently, we've got a very strong business case as to why we spend money on what we do and bringing our young people in, and long may that continue. You know, but there's a lot of detail. You know, we would like some clarity. I'm looking at how we can align our internal programs to an apprenticeship framework that, you know, is here in Scotland and is also in England. The majority of our training and development and recruitment is still here, and that's going to continue. So we need to align it to what is available within Scotland. And, you know, for us, the greatest flexibility that we can get through these levy funds would be ideal. You know, we'd love to get back, you know, every pound that goes in, we'd like to get out. I don't think we're going to see that. But the maximum flexibility as to how we can claim those funds would be great.
Ask finally a very specific question. I think there's a lot of different aspects to this which need to be clarified and looked at. But I think one of them is age. Yeah. And I think for me, you know, the skill system
it's absolutely right that we make sure our young people have the right skills for the world of work. But you know, as we're seeing in the Northeast, you know, the big economic changes can happen. And certainly, you know, I come from the retail industry, which has seen huge technological change. And so I think this is the sort of thing that we need to deal with. Is there an issue here that if we overfocus the levy, but also the wider skill system on younger people, that we actually fail to build a system that actually can cope with those economic changes and the reskilling that we need to do in the future?
Yeah, can I just, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. I mean, we've done a lot of work supporting veterans into the workplace. I mean, you know, the focus on early careers isn't necessarily a young early career. It could be somebody returning to the workplace, for example, a parent, a carer. And that to us is about tapping into the necessary skills. You know, we don't want to put a cap on who we work with and where we draw our talent from. You know, we've seen people coming out of the forces with amazing technical capabilities that we need. Our investment 2020 program has taken in people who've spent 12 years raising children, you know, rejoined the workforce. So, you know, having the right skills and the training capability to, you know, maximize those people's potential is important. And the age thing for us, you know, the focus has been on youth, but it's by no means the only focus.
Questions around
thank you, Convener. A few questions, but maybe I could just follow on this one. Are you saying, Mark Smith, that when it's, I take your point about clarity, but when it's announced as to how this is going to happen, you're going to lose X amount of money into this system, and it comes back to Scotland. You want the Scottish Government to put all of that into training and skills, but in a way not just into the narrow measure of modern apprenticeships. Is that, am I taking you right?
That would be our preferred sort of outcome. Yeah, I mean, my understanding of the English system is that the kind of digital voucher, whereas it's run through PAYE, so you see how much is going out every month, and then you can claim, I think, on a monthly basis. I might not be technically correct. So something which allows us maximum flexibility to claim for the training of our people would be a good thing.
And Gareth Williams, as an industry representative, is that a fair perspective of Scottish business in terms of how they see this, how they'd like to maximise what goes in and therefore what they get out of it?
I think that's fair. There's a recognition that not all businesses are going to be able to get everything out, but they still want to be able to have an influence on how that money is spent to maximum benefit.
Yeah, okay. And Helen Martin, I thought you made some interesting points there latterly about the potential conflict if the policy is very narrowly faced as it currently is south of the border, or could be south of the border, although again, the clarity is not there yet. I was asking earlier on about developing Scotland's young workforce. Seems to me there's just straight up a clash between having a very narrow focus, which, as Mark Smith has just reflected, takes a lot of money out of his business if it's just on one and wouldn't allow us to continue to develop, for example, developing Scotland's young workforce. Is that a fair observation?
Yeah, I think it depends how you design the system. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the challenges that we have here is how do we make this align with the other skills policy requirements that we have within Scotland. I think there is also, on the other hand, the opposite challenge as well about if we design the scheme too broadly and you're allowed to do pretty much anything with the money, then does that undermine the entire concept of an apprenticeship as well? Because we have been very, very tight in Scotland about what we consider an apprenticeship, and it has been based on industry standards, and it has been very, very tightly designed, whereas in England that concept is already much, much looser. So it's not beyond our ability, I think, to marry all of these things together, but I do think we have to recognise the fact that there are going to be tensions within the system, and there are principles that we're trying to defend, as well as trying to design a system that actually does work for the Scottish economy. And I think it is also an opportunity to really get into this idea of creating an infrastructure that allows us to think about what we need for the Scottish economy as well, and to get away from kind of an arbitrary target-driven process that is about a sort of top-down policy lever, because we will finally have employers and unions around the table together who can sit and talk about skills needs and skills development and design solutions and pipelines that work with sector by sector, rather than necessarily always having to be driven from that kind of outside government.
But none of you are arguing we need to kind of reinvent the whole wheel again, are we? I mean, the last thing I think we need to do is rip the whole lot up and start again. I mean, just because there's a new thing called the apprentice levy. I mean, I still think developing Scotland's young workforce is a great programme. We should be doing an awful lot more of it. But is your collective view, I'm sure SDS take this view as well, that the, you know, don't reinvent it all, but if we're going to have some new monies, by all means concentrate those on the programmes that are working effectively. Yeah, yeah, fine. Okay, what I wanted to ask about the skills review. There's an SCDI submission that we've seen sight of, Gareth, and it says in it that there is some duplication and confusion among others, and some interventions lack scale. There's a line in your submission about the skills review, which you've kindly provided to the committee. Could you just talk to that line? I mean, what is the duplication and confusion among users that your members are concerned about?
Yeah, I think it's widely recognised that the skills landscape is cluttered, as you've seen in our submission to the committee. We're most directly involved in the STEM area, and when you start to map out all the interventions in that particular area, you can't fit them on a side of A4, nowhere near that. And I think there is I think that's replicated in other areas as well. And a lot of the work that's going on is very good, and we wouldn't want to denigrate that in any way, but it does become more of a challenge for employers to navigate their way in, and for those initiatives to achieve a scale and a national reach, and an input from employers that we all know from the work that the Wood Commission has done is essential.
Yeah.
And another example would be in the digital area, which is obviously a very high priority. But there are a number of initiatives in that area that are specifically aimed at tourism businesses, for example, or on which tourism businesses can draw. And they all would appear to be struggling to achieve their aims because of partly because of that confusion. So we think there's a lot of positive things in the system. I mentioned apprenticeships and the work that SDS do on digital, my world of work, for example, are all widely appreciated. Mm.
Why is this confusion there? I mean, these bodies under that the skills review are looking at are all government bodies.
Mm-hmm.
So presumably the minister or the civil servants who are sponsoring these bodies are responsible for making sure there isn't confusion and there is clarity.
But I think it's important to note that our comments and our submission aren't just reflecting the number of government bodies, not just those four agencies that are specifically referenced within the review.
Yeah.
And albeit that there are issues between those bodies, and I think we would always want to see a no wrong door approach applied across all of those bodies. The reference that I was making was more to the wider interventions that take place from public, private sectors and so on, and the need, I think, for greater clarity across those, not necessarily reducing them all to one, but at least making it easier for employers.
Yeah. And as an employer, Mark Smith, do you have a view on this?
The landscape is very, very cluttered. So I sit on the board for Developing Young Workforce for Edinburgh, Mid Lothian, East Lothian. You know, one of the ambitions is that, you know, you take a strategic view of that landscape and you say, you know, how do you cut through some of the noise to actually connect employers who want to do something with schools and colleges that want you to do something with them? And, you know, in essence, that's a very simple, very noble ambition, but in practice, it's actually, you know, there's an awful lot of noise. Now, I kind of maintain from colleagues and different things that I'm involved in that, you know, most employers are doing something, but what we don't know, what we don't have a strategic view on, is are they doing the right things? You know, are they connecting the right skills gaps? Are they playing the right interventions with schools and colleges that are needed? And do schools know what provision is out there? You know, do we have a sense of what the gold standard interventions are that are available to all the skill sets and all the age groups? And you know, we should do, but we don't. So actually, you know, absolutely, it's crowded, it's cluttered. There's a lot of good intention, but you know, I guess the fear with DYW and city deals, and are we just adding more and more complexity and more layers that make it harder for employers and schools and young people to connect? You know, we do a number of things to just under our own steam, because that's something that we feel passionately about. And we would always try and offer the provision that we make available to all schools. You know, we don't want to sort of have one relationship with one school, for example, because, you know, you want everyone to have that opportunity. Mm-hmm. It's not easy.
No. And how would you simplify it? What would be your master? I mean, presumably your point is about Edinburgh, because yeah. That's where you are a major employer. I'm not expecting you to solve Scotland's problems, but...
well, we probably haven't got there.
We haven't got all day, have we? But in Edinburgh, how would you simplify? What would you do?
I mean, what's just launched recently is a tool called Marketplace. So this is an invitation for every employer to list their offer, their proposition, if you like. And that is a space that joins education and employers, and so schools and colleges can access that, see what's available, and just draw it down, make the connection. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the nice thing, and this is where I'm pleased that, you know, we do try and work in partnership. So, the DYW board, you know, we kind of took the bid from SDS to work with them to build a platform, so that we don't end up building a platform that's only good for one part of the country. It can be replicated across the whole of Scotland because it's a good piece of software. Mm-hmm. That's just one aspect. I actually think, you know, there's a danger that you make it too complicated. You want a forum where young people and employers can connect. Now, that might be digital, it might be real. We've worked with the Prince's Trust on a concept called Get Hired, which our charitable trust has funded, and it's very straightforward. You know, the Prince's Trust find, you know, disengaged young people. They work with them, they help them get job ready, and they, in the morning of each Get Hired day, they do skill sessions. With volunteers on CVs, interviews, and in the afternoon, real employers come into that environment and interview them for a real job there and then. So they have brokered an introduction between, you know, talented young people who maybe haven't been formally recognised as having that talent and employers. So, you know, a physical environment where young people and employers can come together on neutral ground can't be hard to engineer. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Can I ask Gordon McGuinness, just presumably you'd accept there are different ways to do this in different parts of the country, because Edinburgh's circumstances with major employers like Standard Life would be very different from some of the rural areas that some of the rest of us represent, with, well, a combination of both big oil companies and very small engineering companies. Is SDS's approach to reflect that? I mean, I think developing Scotland's young workforce is a good example of where, I know your different partnership boards in different parts of the country are doing different things, because that has to reflect the circumstances, at the same time as trying to declutter or get rid of the noise, I think, as Mark Smith elegantly puts it.
I think, and I was going to reference the development of Marketplace, because there's a danger that we're going to end up with multiple employer-facing websites. So we've done good work with Mark and the team at the Edinburgh DYW Group, and working hard across the national DYW Group with Rob Edwards and others to adopt the Marketplace system as the kind of national model, which can be adapted at a local level. So we've got a larger employer like Arnold Clark with multiple locations, for example, or Scottish Water can identify the areas, geographical locations they can play into. That wider cluttered landscape is a mix of charities, initiatives, local activities, probably most congested in the STEM area, and we've started a piece of work with the Scottish Government to produce a coordinated STEM strategy across the education system. We're finding that colleges were rightly having a focus in STEM, but coming up with a strategy which potentially didn't sit comfortably with, say, a local education authority. So the more cohesion you can bring into systems at a strategic level, and importantly get a strong link into the curriculum, into the learning outcomes that are designed, so design initiatives that fit and work with lesson plans as opposed to a new initiative which sits out with the curriculum is key. Mm-hmm. Locality is important, and I sit on the UHI FE Regional Board, so I'm familiar with many of the challenges that the Highlands and Islands place, particularly on the larger employers in their area, because they're seen as the go-to businesses. And I think we need to be creative in terms of using some digital content, which would do some of the basic stuff in terms of things like interview skills and that type of activity. And just be UHI, I think, use technology far more effectively than many of the other regional colleges through necessity. So I think it's one to work at. The regions in terms of the Highlands and Islands are probably a bit more work to be done at a national level in terms of the DYW group, but we're working with them on that.
Final question, if I may, Convener. When Ian Wood published his report in June of 2014, his challenge was that less than 30% of Scottish businesses have any contact of any kind with education, and only 27% of employers offer work experience opportunities. Have those numbers got better in the last couple of years?
They are. I think they are getting better. DYW groups, I'm thinking of Ayrshire in particular, a very aggressive campaign with the local employers, but they've had a history there of coordinated work experience at a school level. But I think it's one that more employers are becoming aware of. We've tried to coordinate activities through some of our sectoral work, through the industry leadership groups with groups like Scotland Food and Drink and others, and provide a coordinated, so you're getting a better quality of engagement and a more consistent approach at a national level, but it can be applied at a local level as well.
Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Very much following on from Tavish's theme of questioning. In the previous session, we're looking at further and higher education. I asked Shona Struthers round about the regionalisation and the merger of colleges and kind of what she would place down as a criteria for judging the success. She'd said that actually she'd seen greater cooperation between sort of businesses, employers and colleges. Since the merger programme, has that been your experience, and have you found that greater cooperation compared to before? I just want to get a sense of how have the changes impacted the sort of the relationship and the cooperation that you have with colleges across the country.
I mean, to be honest, my insight into that is limited. I mean, we've had good relationship with Edinburgh College, especially around the formation of the Foundation Apprenticeship, and their role in shaping, developing the young workforce. And they're a key partner in that regionally here. So my experience and my interaction so far has been a positive one. I think, you know, that's really all I can say about it. I mean, we've engaged. It's worked well. I don't really have anything to benchmark it against as to what went before, to be perfectly honest.
I think it's important to recognise that some of the colleges had very strong links with employers prior to the changes, and some of those were set up on more of a regional basis. We think that progress has been variable. Some of the college regions, for example, Ayrshire, certainly have stepped up and are forging closer links, and some of that is related to the development of city-region partnerships or regional partnerships as well. There have been other areas where progress has been a bit slower, and hopefully that will become more evident soon. I think in principle it's a good move. It should offer greater clarity for relationships between schools and colleges and employers, and potentially we would like to see universities plugged more into that as well, so that while relationships might be diverse, at least every school would know their college that they would draw on for mutual support and endeavour, similarly with universities, and that employers would be clear as well on that really on those relationships on a regional basis.
I think we maybe have a slightly different perspective on this. I don't think it's fair to say that things are improving in terms of relationships with college, which is from a kind of workplace level, maybe not so much an employer level. Certainly for workers who are trying to undertake learning, the opportunities to do so at colleges now are much, much reduced in terms of there's much less part-time provision, there's much less night courses, there's much less community learning. Even our own learning project, who commission work in terms of, it's Scottish Union Learning, we commission different like learning courses that are designed by the needs of workers. So we'll decide, okay, we want to do a sign language course, or we want to do, a specific skill, a very workplacey kind of skills course, and we'll design what the course looks like, and then we'll tender it out. The number of colleges in a position to respond to those tenders even has gone down. So that's like commercial work, really. And it's because there is much more of a focus on full-time learning for 18 to 24-year-olds than there is on sort of lifelong learning and flexible learning for workers within the workplace. In terms of like links with employers, I know we have had very good links in the past, and through Scottish Union Learning, again, we've done quite a lot of skills pipeline development in specific areas. I'm thinking, for example, of the bread industry. There was a number of bakers in one area of Scotland, and we designed a sort of skills pathway for a particular level of baker who was in very short supply at that point. And we did that in partnership with the college. So, I mean, the role of the college in the skills pipeline is absolutely essential. And we have the impression that the merger process was very disruptive to that role. And it's now about trying to really build back up those kind of relationships. But I think there are some issues still about how the mergers are bedding in and how staff time can be used at the minute. So I think there are potentially still quite a few issues in Scotland in the college sector.
Thanks. I think, as Gareth said, some colleges had a strong relationship with local employers. I'm on the board of Clyde College now. One of its initial colleges was Cardonald, and a long history of industrial partnership, particularly into gas, water projects, that type of thing. So there was a legacy there. It's early, I think, in terms of regionalisation. Everybody just thinks it happens and everything's fixed. There's a process of bedding in. You've touched on, colleagues touched on, in Ayrshire College, and bringing 2.5 colleges together, and they've strong relationship across that Ayrshire region, with much more engagement with industry to help shape provisioning curriculum. SDS and John Kemp mentioned earlier, we produce evidence bases, which are around regional skill assessments, and that's a detailed analysis of the demographic profile of the region, economic conditions within it. That's informed through Scottish Enterprise, that's from the Funding Council. That's supplemented by the work we'll do around sectoral development plans, of which we'll get 10. And those will be cornerstones for the regional colleges to plan their regional outcome agreements on. And I think through that planning process, if I look at Dumfries and Galloway, they used the early outputs from that to just adjust the provision. Their engineering provision, they grew, but they also grew the technicality of that to a higher level, which was what local businesses were needing. They didn't abandon hairdressing and beauty altogether, but they reduced numbers a little so they got a better spread of their activities. And they deepened their engagement around vocational experience and modern apprenticeships within the region. And that was done through conversations from the senior management team, Carol Turnbull, and through the board. And that's, I think, what we're looking for, is to use that evidence base to get a better picture of what your curriculum plan would be like for the area. If we look at Glasgow, we've been doing work with the local authorities within the City Deal region, and also the Glasgow Regional Board, the three large colleges within that. There was 9 colleges in Glasgow before, so they never actually planned a curriculum across the city centre in the way that they now can, and they're making good use of the evidence base that we've done. So the positive developments in terms of planning, what Helen describes, I suppose, as pressure in the system in terms of the fluidity of their budgets. Joanne made the point earlier on around women returners programmes, that type of thing. It's getting the evidence base from that type of thing and proving it's worth, that's something that's worth investing in. And I think all too often the colleges didn't capture what the outputs and outcomes from that type of activity was.
It relates slightly tangentially to Ross's point. The workers who often don't have access to further educational opportunities or are passed over for skills training and development tend to be those in the most precarious forms of employment, zero-hours contracts, temporary work, etc. how do we ensure that we're not creating a vicious circle for these people where other workers are passing them by because these opportunities simply aren't available to them?
Would they pick up? It's a good question. There's issues around digital exclusion there. Literacy and numeracy is still a big issue for us, and I think impacts in terms of local authority budgets, in terms of what happens through community education, which would have been the traditional portal for people to enter the system. Your visit to Stirling would have been into that type of venue. And that's the areas where provision has actually fallen back, I believe, fairly significantly. We've been doing some work around literacy and numeracy levels. So issues and priority have been placed around closing the attainment gap is fine to put a strong focus in the schools. But if kids go home in the evening and the parents can't either help them with their homework to a sufficient standard, or they struggle themselves with literacy and numeracy, and I think there needs to be a kind of broader recognition of those basic skills for employment. If somebody's 25 and in the workplace and struggles with literacy and numeracy, they could potentially be there for another 40 years. So I think whether we can use digital technology more effectively to support that, but I think that would be an area where we should look and apply some scrutiny.
Feel free, please.
This is an issue that we feel extremely strongly about at the STC, as you might imagine. The prevalence of precarious work is increasing within our economy, and it is a real problem that we are creating a two-tier workforce, that we have groups of workers who are in precarious contracts, be they agency workers, zero-hour contracts, umbrella contracts, a whole range of things that are designed to keep you by design in a precarious situation, to mean that the employer can use your labour at their will and that they don't have to worry about paying you sick pay, they don't have to train you, they don't have to bring you through into the workplace proper in a way that you would really want to see. We just think that this is frankly unacceptable, and we think that there has to be a policy focus on precarious work, and there has to be an expectation that employers do not keep people in precarious work for years and years and years, and they just are excluded from training opportunities, they're excluded from apprenticeships offer under the apprenticeship levy, for example. We have to ensure that workers in those contracts are either we seek to move them off those contracts, or we are giving people proper skills pathways into other forms of work. Employers will often say that these are good contracts, that they provide flexibility, but I actually think there are better ways to provide flexibility within our labour market than to keep people in a position where they don't know if they're going to be able to pay their mortgage from one end of the month to the next. And we also find that there are big equality dimensions to this as well. So BME workers are clustered in precarious grades, female workers are clustered in precarious grades, young workers are clustered in precarious grades. And it isn't actually the case that these workers necessarily have skills shortages. They can be graduates, they can be very highly skilled people, actually, who just, this is the work that they've got into, and it is extremely difficult to get back out again. And I think that is a structural problem in our labour market that we have to focus on.
Is there a significant difference in how easy employers make it to organise and unionise these workers compared to other workers in more secure kinds of employment?
It is much more challenging to organise a precarious workforce, but it is something that we have a big focus on at the minute. I don't know if you've seen our Better Than Zero campaign.
Yeah.
The difficulty really is that if you try to advocate in the usual way for these workers, they are so precarious that they simply don't get taken back. There's no dismissal as such. They no longer receive hours because they're unionised and they're causing problems in the workplace. You can stop receiving hours because you take your child to the doctor one day. So, becoming a union rep isn't really an option. And it's very difficult, therefore, for the union to organise in the traditional way, which is why we are using leverage campaigns to organise for for vulnerable workers, which is essentially about direct action rather than traditional forms of organisation. And as we've seen with Sports Direct this week, which started as a leverage campaign from Unite, that can have really quite dramatic impacts on how workers are treated within the workplace. But I do think that it is important that we start to see precariousness at work for what it is, which is a form of exploitation, and that we start to ensure that people who are in these grades do get opportunities to improve their skills and do get opportunities to move through into the workplace. Because, you know, these are contracts that are increasingly being used in the public sector. They're being used in the NHS, they're being used in universities. This is becoming more and more legitimate as a form of work. And it is important that we, that these workers are not being carved out of our skills agenda, and that we are seeing ways of bringing people into a better situation.
I mean, from our point of view, you know, we don't have 0 hours contracts. We're a living wage employer, and we're a living wage friendly funder from our charitable stuff. So, you know, this to us, you know, we believe passionately in, you know, real jobs, real wages, and, you know, we do that, and we do it through our supply chain. But, you know, obviously there's a problem. I mean, for us, when we started getting involved in this work 5 or 6 years ago, it was easy carving opportunities for school leavers. Okay, and you know, I'll share this anecdote. When I was asked to take it over, I went up to our seventh floor, and there were rows and rows of desks, and these 16, 17-year-olds were being set in exam conditions. And I turned to the woman who was running the program. I said, well, "What are we doing?" Like, well, they're doing their aptitude test and their whatever's. I said, yeah, but we know they're no good at maths. We've already seen the, you know, what are we learning that's new? So we stopped that. And so, you know, I'm not an HR professional, but instinctively I knew that that was putting additional barriers in the way of people accessing, you know, genuine opportunities with us. And then we turned off, you know, minimum qualification attainment for school leavers. You know, if someone's got the ability and they want to work with us, you know, do I care if they've got one hire? Or, you know, if they're the right person, they're the right person. They deserve the chance. So it's easy for us to take a principal position because obviously financially, you know, we've got resources and we can do that. But we do try and influence and help others where we can. And I, you know, when we sort of got our own house in order, you know, that's when we start to sort of talk more publicly about living wage and publicly about skills and this kind of stuff. And I remember using a phrase which got me into a wee bit of trouble, a terrible corporate phrase about moving further upstream. You know, if we were helping people post-education find jobs and access and paying living wage and stuff, that was fine. But how do we make sure we turn off the tap? How do we start influencing further upstream so people coming through education and as they transition from primary to secondary education, how do we make sure that, you know, people who are vulnerable, who come from chaotic, but how do they get the support they need? So as an employer, you know, there's not much we can do in that space. But as a funder, there is. So therefore, we start partnering with a charity called Skillforce, with an award to help people transition from junior to secondary education, partner with Career Ready so that people from disadvantaged backgrounds get access to employers and jobs like ours, and mentoring from staff that we have, so they're not excluded. So there are things that employers can do, but it does come back to this question of, do the employers who want to get involved, do they know what is available? Do they know what the best interventions are to get behind and to support? So, you know, to the question earlier on, you know, what would I like to see? I would love us as a country to strip back and make some brave decisions about some of the things that we do fund and that we do support, and really focus on the things that do make a difference. What they are, I'll leave up to far more qualified people to identify than me.
I think the Fair Work Convention and the labour market strategy offer an opportunity to start addressing these issues. I think we do need to generally raise our sights on workplaces and have more of a focus on that, including quality of leadership, management, and how people are treated. There's been, and Helen made reference to, a number of very disappointing cases which tell a larger story. At the same time, I think we do have to acknowledge that the world of work is changing and people will work more on a project basis where they come together for a particular task, and there are higher aspirations around working flexibly and probably changed expectations of careers as well and the number of different roles that those will involve. So it's getting balance is the wrong word, but in addressing those very fundamental issues, trying to push people into choices that they themselves wouldn't necessarily want to make.
Hey, Gillian, you've got some questions you'd like to ask. And we're just going to draw it to a close now. We've got Gillian and Dalton, and that'll be the last two.
Short question. Come back to something you said a long time ago now, which was about the challenges for rural areas. I'm representing a rural area. So it's very interesting to me what you see those challenges as being and how they maybe could be addressed around getting apprenticeships for people in those more remote areas.
There's probably a kind of misconception in terms of it's only larger employers that actually take apprentices. The vast majority of apprentices will be with small to medium-sized companies. So there will tend to be employers within areas, and that's part of the work we're doing around the expansion plan is looking at, and we report on a fairly detailed geographical basis in terms of apprenticeship uptake across the apprenticeship groups and occupational areas. So we wouldn't say out with probably the island communities where there are challenges, and that's where we see the foundation apprenticeship model has been a better model to connect young people to local employers and actually create a relationship rather than young people thinking they need to move away to get a job. There's opportunities there. Now, touched on it earlier, the number of employers within a local area and the opportunities to deliver consistently around the foundation apprenticeships will be challenging, and that's something that we're working with. So stronger partnerships between the colleges who are supporting the apprenticeships and the local schools. And I think we will need to think creatively around how we use things like digital technologies and others to give people a kind of start into a career.
And I suppose there's issues around, you're talking about sort of smaller businesses, yeah. And obviously Mark's remit is dealing with this whole thing, you're a very large company, but for a very small employer, you're taking on this additional responsibility, something you need support for.
And that's a challenge, and that's been identified. FSB undertook, Federation of Small Business undertook a study 2 years ago now through Rocket Science, which identified the challenges for small businesses are making that commitment. They don't have an HR team. There's been a number of models undertaken in terms of pilot work around shared apprenticeships within geographical regions. There's one in Dundee and Angus just now, and there's one related to construction in the Highlands. Again, coming back to the apprenticeship levy and potentially some additional and flexible resource in there, is there models like that that you could create? It comes back to the structure of the apprenticeship model. We want employers to make a commitment in terms of employment to young people, and that's not say it's a stumbling block, it's a good stumbling block, and it's a good principle to have, but more probably needs to be done in terms of information and support, in terms of supporting small and micro businesses to recruit young people.
Yeah, okay, thank you, that's all I had.
Right, thank you. Fulton, you've got a question then, Richard.
Thanks, convener. My question's on skills for the future. And I'm just wondering what sort of role or what you've got in terms of identifying what the future skills are rather than living, you know, in the here and now. The papers I've got in front of me here, are saying a statistic that I wasn't aware of, you know, that 65%, well, children that are going to primary school just now, 65% of them will end up in jobs that don't currently exist. I found that an amazing start, and I'm just wondering what you guys are doing in your various roles and functions to look at what the future skills might be.
I'll pick up, thanks, Fulton. A lot of the work that we undertake with the sectors, so industry leadership groups exist for Scotland's key and growth sectors, supported by Scottish Enterprise and Scottish Government, and they help to set an industrial strategy for sectors. So we work alongside those groups to look at both growth ambitions for the companies and what the future skills might be as they understand them. And then we produce the skill investment plans, which are an articulation of future skill needs, both in terms of the types of skills, but also the volumes as well. there's some emerging stuff that will take place, and there's been dialogue yesterday around the FinTech, which is that merger of financial and technical skills, which they say could transform the financial services industry. We're doing some work with Scottish Enterprise and Deloitte just now to look at what the opportunities and threats are there. Some potential threats around the digitalisation of employment that could take swathes of employment out of things like call centre operations and that type of thing. So we're looking at those future skill needs as well. We'll look at international research. We're just concluding a study just now, or a report just now, looking at jobs to 2022 and forward projections, understanding where the growth areas are, but also understanding where the replacement demand for skills are, and somebody touched on it earlier around things like the health services and others. So there is jobs growth, obviously, in Scotland, but the largest number of jobs required in the labour market will come through replacement demand, addressing the needs of those who are coming up to retirement age. And things like the health boards, for example, will be quite heavily hit by the levy. They're not going to be able to put another few percentage points onto the bills to their customers. So the government and ourselves need to think creatively as how you support that. So somebody like Glasgow and Clyde, for example, could be paying £6 million into a levy fund. They have significant skill challenges moving ahead in terms of the age profile of the workforce, but you can apply that to engineering companies or any other organisation, and it's understanding that balance of what the skills system needs to produce to replace that to future replacement demand, as well as responding to the new stuff.
I suppose as well that, you know, I wonder if there's any way we can link that into another discussion point that's come up across all the panel today, and that's in terms of, to use the phrase, you know, getting to the hardest to reach people. You know, the initiative in Stirling that Daniel talked about, he went to last week, and also I visited a Routes to Work programme in my own constituency in Coatbridge. Seems to me that they're doing a lot of work, they're picking up a lot of stuff, and they're doing a lot of work to get to people who are finding it difficult to get into employment. And I wondered then, you know, in terms of the skills of the future, identifying that, if there's also some thoughts about that being done in conjunction with, you know, looking at the people that are most hard to employ.
The Scottish government, in terms of policy structure, have a skills pipeline, which is segmented into four strands. So activity, and this is how public sector organisations, ourselves and local authorities and the colleges view provision. So that first line of the pipeline is really around engagement with those who are disengaged, and then is helping young people to move through that skill pipeline, not just young people but adults as well. And that's maybe something we can go back with a bit more detail on for yourself, just because it is a Scottish Government framework, and it's yep. worked well, it's helped. Local employability partnerships to say, well, how much provision do we have for each part of the pipeline, and do we have stepping points, transition points for young people to move through the system towards more sustainable jobs?
Yeah. Richard, last question.
Okay, I'll keep it brief. Just to ask about Brexit and looking ahead to the challenges of skills gaps and needing people to be taxpayers in the future, and all the debates taking place over the last few years about that, and that leads us into people from overseas coming to work in Scotland. So how are you feeling about the potential impact of Brexit on meeting those challenges, and what steps do you feel you can take to try and prepare Scotland for these potential challenges in the future?
Finish with an easy one, eh? The Scottish Government has established a cross-agency group which has been pretty well publicised, and Skills Development Scotland has been working with the Government, Scottish Enterprise, Highlands and Islands Enterprise to look at the evidence base and reform that. Trying to remember the name of the specific report, but a UK level report gives us a breakdown and the Scottish sample size, looking at industrial sectors and the makeup of both foreign nationals and UK migrants as part of the workforce. And we've done an initial analysis of that, So areas obviously won't come as a surprise, but tourism and food and drink heavily, and it can be in some of the subsectors up to 35% of the workforce can be made up with the EU nationals. So the decisions about what will happen to individuals in that category, whether they'll be able to stay or whether they'd be have to return to their home country. But I think we also need to think, even if they do stay, what would the future flow would be like, because some of our sectors have been heavily dependent on it. There are some sectors in terms of life sciences, which again have been dependent on international recruitment as well, maybe more from the States. So any immigration system, whether it's point-based or whatever else, needs to have a strong influence, to because it needs to support the Scottish government. The current migration policy is quite challenging, and they've introduced a new levy system into that as well, and also with conditions that if employment categories are identified as suitable for recruitment, then the home nation then needs to demonstrate that there's a skills plan in place to meet those needs. So in areas like digital coding, for example, we've responded partly to industry and with industry and around things like CodeClan, because that's currently on the list in terms of recruitment. So we can demonstrate that we're taking actions to do that. But longer term, I think it will depend on decisions that are taken at a UK level for some sectors, and for some seasonal sectors like soft fruit and others, it's going to be pretty challenging if that potential flow of labour is turned off.
Yeah, there's short-term pre-Brexit issue as well, the uncertainty of people who are here already and the impact that might have on their ability to get a mortgage, for example, and whether they would just choose at some point, given all that uncertainty, to return home. Helen and I are both involved in the post-study work visa working group, which is a cross-party group involved, Liz and others. And I think we have presented a strong case to the UK government on why there's an economic need to reintroduce that flexible route. We haven't had much of a positive response so far, despite what was said in the Smith Commission and the cross-party support and broad business and education support that exists and trade union as well. But we keep trying to make that case, and the new minister's in post, a new context, hopefully we'll at least be able to get a foot in the door at some point and develop a scheme. And the other aspect I wanted to mention was in terms of our own young people and whether if our international priorities change and we need to export more to non-European parts of the world, whether those require different language and cultural skills as well, and we need to think about that and prioritise that, particularly as we all know that we need to improve the know-how within our businesses on exporting.
I'm tempted to say I don't. It's way above my pay grade, our strategic approach to Brexit. So I'll keep it in terms of skills. You know, we recruit locally, nationally, internationally. That's not going to change. The key thing is that we have the right candidates, and we will work on investing in skills in the pipeline to make sure we've got a broad, rich, deep talent stream to fish in. A terrible analogy, but you know, that's in our We believe in that, and we will continue to work and invest in that, and we will continue to recruit internationally, nationally, and locally. And you know, one thing I would like just to kind of to focus on is this sense of, you know, developing people's core skills. We touched very briefly earlier on this question of the future world of work and what skills are going to be needed. And, you know, obviously we don't know, you know, what's going to be in another 20 years. I mean, we can make some wild sci-fi led guesses. But the ability for people to kind of build strong career foundations on core skills, teamwork, confidence, communication, that's not going to change. And so, you know, the earlier we can kind of make good interventions in education and early years, that's got to be a good thing for society as a whole and for us as an employer, because we all reap the benefits.
I think from our point of view, we are we have some concerns about the effect of Brexit just on certain sectors of the economy. It's very much dependent on what deal is struck with the European Union and what access we have to the common market, and what access we have to what deals we do with other parts of the world in trade agreements, and what the conditionality comes with that. I think there are certainly sectors that we can identify as more vulnerable than others to some of these challenges, manufacturing sectors in particular, and we would be looking to the government to put support in place for sectors that are facing particular vulnerabilities at this time and in this transition. We're concerned about the status of European nationals. I think, as many people on the panel have suggested, there are certain workplaces that without the European nationals, they simply wouldn't function, like the NHS, for example. Our universities are obviously very particular within that as well. We're hopeful that certainly good outcomes can maybe be achieved for European workers who are currently in post. But I think the question then comes, as Gordon rightly said, about what happens with the flow of labour, what happens for seasonal workplaces and for people who are dependent on a kind of low-skilled labour from the European Union, because to date we basically have an immigration system that has no low-skilled labour element within it, because it has all come from the European Union. So we are now have a question about how it is that we design an immigration system that includes a component of low-skilled labour. And I don't think we've really had any discussion about that as a country, about the sorts of principles that we'd like to see behind a system of that nature. And I think it is quite a serious question for A, how our workplaces survive, but also about what's acceptable to the wider community and what people want to see in these sorts of systems going forward. We are also a little bit concerned, and I wouldn't want to overstate it, but we do have an eye on the issue of tensions within workplaces. And I think that has not just about tensions between European and non-European workers, but I think that stretches out into tensions between different ethnicities of workers more generally. And I think it's important that we make sure that within all of this process that we are not allowing a racist discourse to creep into our policies, and we're not allowing that to kind of play out at a workplace level or a community level. And that's something that trade unions are very concerned about, and that we will certainly have a focus on in the next period.
Thanks very much for that, and thanks for that simple question to finish with, Richard. Can I thank the panel for very, very briefly, please?
Very briefly, just to come back on the target that we had set around disability. Our target is to increase the employment rate for young disabled people to the population average by 2021, and to have a correlation, and MA starts to match that. That's 12.5% presently. We have a midpoint target in 2017-18 of 6% of all MA starts, and that will be reviewed on an annual basis thereafter.
Okay, thanks very much. And once again, thank you very much for the panel for attending today. That brings us to the conclusion of the public part of the meeting today. So if non-panel members could leave the room, thank you.